Hey, everybody. Welcome to the very first episode of the Whiskey Throttle Show, brought to you right here at the Troy Lee Design Saloon. We've got a hell of a show for you today. Kicking it off here, we're going all out. We've got Roger DeCoster, the man, arguably the most successful guy in the entire sport of motocross. That's a great bench racing segment. We can get into that later, but certainly you can look at his career and his statistics and make that argument. He's brought to us by PowerDot. We're going to go into his whole life and career and his recent step into retirement. But we've got some other segments as well. We want to talk to you about the Method Race Wheels front end chatter. So we're going to kind of get into just some conversation about what's going on, current events and things like that. We've got the Decal Works last call session. That's going to get weird. I'm not going to lie to you. We're going to have some fun with that. And finally, we'll be answering any and all questions on the Four Wheel Parts Q&A, the Get At Me Q&A segment. So lots of fun stuff going on, but a big crux of this is going to be focusing on Roger DeCoster and his career, his life. But before we get into that, let me introduce you to the team. I'm David Pingree. I'm going to be your host. With me is a guy with six championships, a 125 World Championship, a 125 National Championship, two 250 Supercross Championships, a 450 National Motocross Championship, a Supermoto Championship. Between the two of us, six titles. I mean, we are kicking ass. Yes, they are all grants, but we're a team, and that's what teammates do. We kind of share. Buddy, welcome to the show. We made it to show one.
Well, it's unbelievable to be here, and thanks to everyone involved. Ping, this has been quite the journey to be here at show one, and like you said, show one's got to be a showstopper, so who else better to bring than Roger DeCoster, and he was so willingly to oblige, and that, I think, was pretty cool. And one thing we know about Roger is we don't know a lot about Roger. We know what Roger's done past racing, but, you know, who is Roger and when and how and all that? I think this is going to be great, and we got some great sponsors. You can see some of them behind us, and this is cool. I'm telling you, we're going to have some great guests, and this season is going to be one heck of a journey.
It's going to be a lot of fun. And, my, you know, I was talking to Roger a little bit before the show, and I just said I'm excited to learn about your GP days. I've never heard you talk about it. I've never heard people get into that in an interview, you know, series with you. And usually everything is something current events, you know, what's going on with the team now? What's, you know, what are you up to?
Who do you think is
going to
win?
Yeah.
How's he looking? Yeah.
Whatever. I want to know about the GP days. And we're going to find out about that tonight. I want to introduce you to the other part of our team. So over here behind his very expensive Apple computer, this thing can run a podcast and also, I think, launch spacecraft into orbit. Is that right? Paid enough for it, so it better be able to. Anyway, this is Donnie Bales over here. If anyone's familiar with the Motocross 101 DVD that I put out, or Grant's DVD and his instructional ride, what was that called? You don't remember the name of it? Anyway,
I have six championships. That's what it's called.
Yeah. Anyway.
What is it called? Help me out here. I'm drawing a blank.
It's available on iTunes if you can find the name of it. Mine is Motocross 101. Anyway,
mine's
moving on.
What's it? A day?
Learning to ride with Grant Lincoln.
Okay, there you go. Yeah, it was very tough. That's why I couldn't think of it.
Yeah, it was really an elaborate name. Good job. Anyway, Donnie produced videos for both of us, so it was kind of an organic way that we all came together to produce this show and put it together. And I'm excited, personally. I think we've got a little bit of interesting chatter with our guest, and we also have some funny stuff, some kind of stupid stuff. It's going to be a good mix.
I was going to say, it pretty much explains us.
Yes.
Hey, can I join in that six championships, too, by the way?
Oh, what are you going to? You got some, like, local?
No. I want part of his championships the way you got them.
Oh, you want, like, one, and I'll take two, and he gets three?
Yeah, I'd be good with that.
It's like a 3-2-1 special?
I mean, you still got the money, dummy. Just share the share the glory with us. All right. All right, good. We've all got titles. I want to get started. Let's kick right off here with our Method Race Wheels front-end chatter. If you're not familiar with Method Race Wheels, these guys are the official race wheel supplier for Troy Lee Designs and their race team, also their mountain biking team. These guys are making a big push into all kinds of action sports. They produce the fastest, lightest, highest performance wheels in the off-road market, period. So if you're into UTVs, trucks, Jeeps, Sprinter vans, which have become super popular at the races, Method Race Wheels makes the raddest stuff for them, period. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. So check those guys out. We'll get you more familiar with those as the show goes on. So the front-end chatter segment, we had a few little topics. We just kind of want to touch on current events, and I'm going to kick this off with injuries. You know, when we get to this point of the season, it's almost like it's becoming
December.
Who can stay healthy?
Yeah.
Who can avoid injuries going into this last month? And I know you need to push to try to get your pace there and, you've been building this fitness base, and now it's time to make sure you've got the speed. But doing that without getting hurt is tough.
It always is. I mean, every year that, we've been there as a professional, and we got Roger sitting over there as a team manager, you always know it's the nerve-wracking time of the season. You've done your testing. Your guys are in shape. The bikes are dialed. Everything's good. Everyone's trying to maintain. And I kid you not, it's those last 3 weeks leading up to the first round, just things seem to happen, whether it's a freak accident, something unusual. You just never know. I mean, in the 250 class, we've seen that it can benefit some people but not others, because you've got a West Coast and an East Coast, so you have more time. But coming in, when it comes, especially 450 guys, injury is a big problem coming this time of the season.
Yeah, and we see in the 250 class, a guy who's maybe slated to ride West gets hurt, like Christian Craig recently broke his thumb. He's now going to slide over to the East Coast. They pull someone else over. So you've kind of got an out there, particularly if you were going to ride West. They don't have that in the 450 class. Yeah. You've got to be ready for A1 to be in the points. Eli Tomac is fighting through an injury, and I don't think a lot of people know much about this. He's tried to keep it very quiet, but he's been off the bike for a few weeks. He didn't show up to Kawasaki's shoot. No one's really speaking what kind of injury it was, but he's off the bike for a little bit. That's going to affect his prep time, period. There's just no way around it.
I mean, at this point of the season, when you look at the depth, especially in all the classes, and the 450s is probably the deepest it's been in many, many years. I mean, there's always been the top superstars, but it seemed like years ago there was maybe three guys or four or five guys that separated themselves, and then there was kind of a drop-off. Well, over the years, the 250 Supercross and Outdoor Champs have been moving up, and you haven't seen too many guys retire, so it's starting to stack up. So if you're Eli Tomac, one of the favorites, is it a big deal? I think it could be. You know, with so many good riders, I mean, he's even got his younger teammate there who's trying to prove a point. I think it's going to hurt Tomac.
Well, he had him covered at the Monster Cup. He had to move over and let Eli go by for the $1 million. I mean, that tells you that kid's on the pace.
What do you think he got out of that? Set of method wheels?
Maybe something. He better have gotten something. You're going to pull over for a guy.
You may as well put a truck on those wheels, buddy.
Boy, yeah. There's other guys. Marvin Musquin came back from a knee injury, and he's riding again. He's back in the swing, but he definitely missed some time. And as a guy who's had three ACL reconstructions, I can tell you they're never the same. They're never quite the same. And every time you come into a rut, you're kind of thinking about it, making sure you don't hang it up and catch it again. I'm curious to see how he rides with that, if that bugs him again. He didn't fix it, whatever that injury was. I'm just anxious to see how that affects him. We got Mookie, who crashed over in Europe, had an ugly one. I don't know if you saw it on video. It's horrific. He's lucky to have walked away without anything broken, but yeah, Certainly rattled his cage a little bit. Ken Roczen coming back from the broken hands. One right after another. Those things are terrible as well. He far went past what I thought he would be able to come back and do.
I think a lot of people didn't even know if he would come back, truthfully.
No.
So I think with that, what he's done, like even in 2018, his progress after the, other hand issue, it was pretty good. And at times, I think early in the season, people were, round one, he kind of struggled in the first moto. And we thought, I thought maybe he was done for the season. Maybe this was it. And he stuck through it. He kept fighting. And he got to that point where later in the season, I think a lot of people thought, okay, he's going to win. He's going to have that breakthrough. It didn't quite happen. And some people had asked me what you think. And I go, it's kind of like being good at anything. You can work so hard and you get so close. You're like, I'm almost really, really good. And I think he got to that point. Now he's had some time in the offseason. Has he changed anything? Has he had time to recover? Has he progressed from that? Because I think if that's the case, then 2019 could be quite interesting with him.
Well, he's far surpassed anything I thought he would get back to. I was a skeptic when I saw how bad that hand injury was. Bone grafts, surgery after surgery. I thought there's no way he gets that hand back to where he doesn't have numbness and tingling. I just didn't see how he was going to get the vasculature back. And he did. I mean, good. I'm stoked that he did. That's awesome. And I'm anxious to see where he's at coming into 2019. Another guy, this is an interesting topic to me. I think Jason Anderson, who's our current champion, is the underdog coming into this year. If you ask guys who's going to win, it's like Eli, Marvin, Ken. Those are the guys people are talking about. They kind of go, I think Anderson kind of had it handed to him because everyone crashed.
And that comes back to that. That's how championships work. I mean, nothing is ever given to you. You have to earn it. And there were years that we've seen the fastest guy not win, and there's years you see the fastest guy dominate. At the end of the day, Anderson came out. he was sort of the underdog. He flew a little bit under the radar. I think some people said, hey, he's like that guy keep your eye on. And then all of a sudden, halfway through the series, it was like, wow, what just happened? Like, this is almost over immediately. But like you said, when you go into 2019 and people go, well, you know, if you know Marvin's there, Tomac's fast, if he doesn't make, you know. But there's always those ifs, and ifs. And the other thing, too, is there's a lot of riders. I mean, one is staying healthy. Two is you got a lot of competition. And three, I think because Anderson didn't compete in too many of the outdoor nationals because of his injury, it's that old saying in racing, you're only as good as your last race. And I think maybe he's become a little bit in, you know, not in the forefront of the mindset for people, but maybe he's a little bit of, I don't want to say a distant memory, but he's in the back, you know.
Yeah, he's certainly become a little bit of an afterthought or an underdog. And frankly,
but I think that could be a mistake for a lot of people.
I agree. In fact, you know, in the RacerX Supercross preview shows, I picked Eli Tomac to win the title this year. And, you know, afterwards, I thought about it. I'm like, God, I'm probably sleeping on Anderson. I mean, here's a guy who took the summer off to heal that injury. So he's getting nice and rested. He's coming back. This is your series champion from last year. He's probably going to come in swinging and really surprise a lot of people, which shouldn't be a surprise.
You can tell he's got that natural Supercross technique, ability, the way he rides a bike. I think Supercross really works for him. Maybe not so much for outdoors because we've seen that. Guys like Sealy, even Marvin at times, when the track gets rough, you got to learn how to, you know, basically bulldog through there. And for Anderson, I think his strength is in Supercross. I'm not saying he can't ride outdoors. He's obviously, you know, phenomenally good there too. But his wheelhouse is in the stadiums. And he did well in Australia. He's done well in Europe in his offseason. So far, it's, you know, the champ still looks like the champ.
Champ looks good. Absolutely. One more guy I want to touch on when we were talking about injuries, and that's Weston Pike. Undoubtedly had the worst injury this offseason over in Paris, got landed on and had a whole bunch of facial fractures. Really, really scary crash, you know, as a guy who's in the medical profession a little bit, seeing how much blood he had coming out of his airway and being able to protect that from a guy who's unconscious is really scary. And so kudos to the EMS crew over there in France that took care of him. But looks like now he's back on his feet. He's going to make a full recovery. That is awesome. And I want to give a big shout out to Road to Recovery. Those guys went way above and beyond helping him get back to the States. It was an expensive flight, and he's got a long road in front of him. Those guys are standing beside him, helping him. If you can donate to Road to Recovery, I recommend you please do that. It's all tax deductible. And speaking of that, if you want to help them, we have live shows that are going to be happening. Our first one is January 4th, and you can come right here to the TLD Saloon here and watch the Whiskey Throttle Show taped live. We've got cornhole, ping pong, all the 805 beer you can handle. Good times. This is going to be a fun show here when we open it up to the crowds. And every single dollar that we raise, it's $20 for a ticket to come watch the show. That all goes to Road to Recovery. And that's going to help guys like Weston Pike who get hurt and need that help getting back on their feet.
Yeah, no, I think that's something really cool. I mean, those folks from Road to Recovery have been around a while. They've helped a lot of people over the years. You know, Jimmy Button was one of the founders of that with his mom, and they've just taken it and helped, as you said, a lot of people that probably didn't ever think they would need to lean on something like that. No one ever goes into anything planning to get hurt, but when those things happen, all of a sudden you go, wow, how do we do this? There's your safety net, and they've done a lot of good, and so we want to team up with people like that and keep, you know, giving back.
Yeah, we've tried to partner with them. Like I said, you can go to the whiskeythrottleshow.com to buy those tickets or go to roadtorecovery.com. Click on the shop link, and that'll take you right to the Whiskey Throttle page. You can pick up those tickets and help out guys like Weston. Let's move along. I want to get right to our guest. I'm excited. PowerDot is bringing you our guest tonight, Roger DeCoster. If you're not familiar with what PowerDot is, we're going to be explaining that here as the shows go on. We're going to get you guys more familiar with it. It's an electric muscle stimulator, and it's changing the way athletes and individuals who are health-minded are training and recovering and coming back from injury. You know, their motto is recovery for everybody. See what they did there with those play on words? Basically, what this thing does is it's not just a nerve blocker like a TEMS unit. This actually fires your muscle, and whether it's a surgery you're coming back from or an injury, it flushes out lactic acid and any kind of deposits in there. It warms your muscles up before you ride. So if you're talking about arm pump, you run through a cycle on these. It reduces arm pump, re-educates and strengthens your muscles post-surgery or anytime you have an injury. This thing is just absolutely phenomenal. It's the size of a matchbox car. It's tiny. So it's not like the old clunky boxes that some of these other brands give you with all these wires. It's all Bluetooth. Runs right off your phone.
Yeah,
it's incredible. And these guys, if you go to powerdot.com, they're giving 10% off, and 10% of those profits will go to Road to Recovery as well. So 10 off for you, 10 to Road to Recovery. It's a great deal. Check them out at powerdot.com. Again, we're going to get more into those guys, just explaining what those are. We'll
I like the massage feature. As you can imagine, these days I don't deal with arm pump and recovery from workouts. I like the massage feature. Just lean back on the couch.
Yeah. Well, I throw it. My favorite thing is sort of on the back of my neck between my shoulder blades. That's where I tend to lock up and get like this. And you can sit there and watch TV or scroll through, you know, Instagram or whatever while it's working.
And then you wake up the next morning, it's still stuck on your back.
Yeah. Well, maybe. That's all right. Leave it on for a couple days till the pads fall off.
There you go.
All right, let's get right to it. PowerDot bringing you five-time world champion Roger DeCoster. Roger, you mind coming on up? Everybody give a hand to Roger DeCoster. Did you ever ride for Roger at all or work with him?
No. That's another story. I almost did. Maybe I should have.
Yeah, well, we never got there. Let him get set up here.
You go to there. You go,
Roger. Welcome.
Good to be here.
Sorry, we had to bring him up from the audience. First of all, thank you for coming on. I know that you're busy. You've been at the test track all day, you said, and we don't take your time for granted. So thanks a lot for coming on.
You're welcome.
I don't know. I want to just go back and start at the very beginning, and I kind of set some questions out just chronologically. I like I said, I'm very interested in the early GP days because I came onto the scene here in racing in like the mid early 90s. So I've watched what you've done firsthand from then on. It's the stuff before that that interests me. So let's just start with tell us about where you grew up, because I heard a really interesting story about how you got started racing. And I want to hear that again.
I grew up in on the outskirts of Brussels, in Belgium, and I started in my neighborhood on our street. There was the kids on my street. They were all a bit older than I was, and so when I was about 8, 9, 10 years old, the guys on my street already had bike. They were like 17, 18, 20 years old. And I always used to go hang around and watch them work on their bike and cleaning their bike. And soon they let me help them clean their bike and polish it. And the bikes that they had at the time, I'm talking this was in the 50s. There was the Triumphs, BSA, and Nortons were the big bike. All English.
Four
at
strokes,
the time.
Yeah.
Yeah, all four strokes.
Which is funny because they were not around.
They were street bikes. And once a year, we lived next door was a pub.
That could have been dangerous.
That was good for my dad, actually. But once a year, there used to be races in Europe on open streets with street bikes, street motorcycles.
And like Isle of Man style, where they're just...
No, there would be a loop like a 60, 70-mile loop. And they used to use farm roads. They tried to get secondary roads. And they would race like 24 hours, or sometimes 12 hours, sometimes 24 hours. And there was a checkpoint at the pub. And all night, the bikes would come by, you know, for 24 hours, and they would get their stamp there and keep going. And I was maybe 10, 11, 12 years old, and I was on the window all night. Couldn't
just
go to sleep, yeah. And that's what sparked my interest in bikes. And then these older guys on the street, they let me hang out with them, and they would take me with them riding, and then they would bet me that I could not ride their bike up this hill or something, you know, in a little forest next to where we lived, and any chance that I had to ride the bike was I would do anything. And
yeah.
And then I started working in a motorcycle shop and doing, you know, little jobs like changing the oil, adjusting the chain, fixing flat tires, changing cables and things like that. And I saved the money and kept it to us a bike. That was my dream. And I always ask my dad, you know, about buying a bike, but our family did not have the financial means to buy bikes. I had four brothers, all younger than me, and my dad worked in a steel mill, and my dad had a serious drinking problem also, so he would get into a drinking spree and be drunk for 2 weeks straight. Mm-hmm. And then he would feel so bad, and then he would walk like a madman and to make up for it. And he worked in a steel mill, and they worked shifts. He would do two shifts back to back.
12-hour shifts?
Two 8-hour shifts, 16 hours straight. And he would go like that for, I don't know, 4, 5, 6 months, and then he would get into another drinking spree. And
so that bar next door, that pub, was kind of a curse, huh?
Yeah. And by the time I was 16, which was the age that you needed in Belgium to be able to take part in a race, I had saved enough money, and I bought a little race bike. But I did not know enough about racing. I just liked it and watched it. And so the first three races I did, I broke down, you know, there was basically ignition failures, because in Belgium we had a lot of rain. Yeah. And I did not know how to prepare the bike well enough so that it would not be problems with the ignition and with the electrical stuff. So then I was out of money, and I walked through the winter again, and then the next season I had built a combination with another engine, and I bought forks from a street bike that had hydraulic pumps inside, which was new at that time. And with that bike, the first race of the new season, I ended up running. And that was a small race in the junior and all that. And I kept my bike at my friend's house down the street, one of the older guys.
Is it true that your dad didn't know? I've heard that your dad didn't know you raced. He learned by reading it in a paper.
Yeah, he did not know, and they did not want me to race, and it was, you know, it was a lot of pressure to go to school, and I did pretty good in school up to that point.
So you're already ahead in the game compared to most riders if you're doing okay in school. So you're already winning before you started winning.
Yeah, in a way, but... So after winning this race on Monday, my dad always, when he came home from work, he always would read the paper by the fireplace, because there was no central heating in our house, and he always seemed to have cold feet, so he would read the paper, you know, next to the fireplace, and he goes, "Roger, what is this? Is this you?" And there was this tiny little thing, you know, about 1 inch wide and three lines in the paper. Local rider Roger DeCoster wins, you know, junior race. And I go, yeah, it's me. I didn't know you had a bike. Well, he told me I could not have one, you know. And so, where is the bike? Renee down the street and all that. And then a couple of weeks later, there was another race, and he came to watch with some friends from work, and he was already talking. Like, my kid, you know, he's good. And,
you might want to look at it and sign him up.
So from no way to race to...
he's a fan after one win.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So he didn't obviously race or have any interest in motorcycles. That was...
He had a motorcycle for transportation.
Okay.
And actually during the war...
That's pretty common back then in those times. Yeah.
During the war, he actually was a courier in the area of the Battle of the Bulge.
Mm, wow.
So he you know, there was no texting at that time. And he rode a motorcycle to carry messages from on the to the front, you know.
That's more dangerous than racing, probably.
For sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. That's impressive. What was the first bike you bought?
It was a Flandria, a little Belgian bike, but it was terrible. It was such a piece of junk. It was
I actually heard of that when I moved to Belgium. I heard of that bike, and I battled. How do you pronounce it again?
Flandria. It was named after the Flanders in our area, the Flanders.
Flanders.
Huh. What size was it?
It was my first little bike was a 50, and then I jumped from a 50 to a Jawa 500.
Oh, jeez,
that makes sense. That's the natural progression to go from a 50 to a 500. What did racing look like back then? I mean, you said this was basically street racing. Was there scrambles around at that point, or what was the next step?
No, there was motocross, and motocross was actually pretty popular in Belgium, France, Italy. They had big spectator numbers.
I see pictures, and I mean, the hillsides were covered.
Bigger than today, actually. And there was some big races in Belgium. There was a big race near Paris that would have real 25,000 to 40,000 people, 40,000, 45,000 real spectators, not fake numbers,
not puffed out numbers.
Yeah.
That's crazy. So
that is pretty remarkable back then. Do you think it was because basically motocross was new and maybe the cool thing? And
well, it was one of the few motorsports, you know, and I think young people were more fascinated with anything with engines like motorcycles and cars than today. Today, you know, a lot of the young kids they get it's phones and computers and you know, so the
electronics.
So I think we were more fascinated with whatever had an engine, you know, motorcycle, cars, airplanes, you know, like
that was the electronics of the age, was something motorized.
Yeah.
Right? That was what was fun.
Well, it had electronics on it, minimal.
Yeah, well, they broke.
And then
all
Roger
the time,
couldn't figure out how to get it to wrapped up.
The little point.
Yeah, there you go.
So, who were the racers you looked up to back then? And was it that point right away that you got into motocross and started following it, or?
Yeah, but by the time I was when I was working in this motorcycle store, and even before I raced, at that time the English riders were tops and.
Is that because the English were sort of the pioneers or the originators, or I don't know? It seemed like it kind of started.
Well, England had a big motorcycle industry, and Belgium had also a motorcycle industry not as big as England, and so did Italy. But Italy was more focused on on-road racing.
Yeah, street.
England had both, you know, they were big in road racing, but they were also big in motocross and trials. Anything with motorcycles, they were very big. Was very big in England. In Belgium, from the riders that I looked up to at first, because he was from Belgium, also was René Baten. He was a world champion in 1958. He was from Belgium, and he won it on a Belgian brand, the motorcycle called the FN, which was one of the very first purpose-built motocross bikes. It had an engine that was really narrow, which, you know, it's important for motocross. You don't catch
rocks.
Your ruts.
If you look at a lot of the older motors, they stick out in front of your feet.
A lot of the English bikes, especially on the clutch side, where the engine was always, you know, out of center of the bike, and the left side, you know, it was dangerous to catch your feet, you know, in the ruts. But this bike had an engine almost as narrow as today's bikes, but it was very long and very tall. It was, but it was a very powerful bike for the time, and they won a lot of races with that bike.
That's impressive.
And then, as I got a little bit older, I became a big fan of the Swedish riders like Bill Nilsson, Sten Lundin, Gunnar Johansson. Those guys, the Swedes, they kind of built a lot of their own bikes. A lot of it was handmade. They started with a bottom end from an English bike like Albion, or and then they made their own cylinder head and all that, and made their own chassis. Like if you look at the Lito it's which became a Monarch later on, but it was the same people making it. It's just a different sponsors, and Lito was actually a printing company. That's why it's called Lito from Litograph, you know.
Okay. Wow.
And I think that's still one of the coolest bikes if you look them up, you know.
I was gonna say, I haven't seen one.
Well, I just know Monarch. Scott Wallenberg, our yeah. Racer X publisher. You ask him a question about Monarch, and you better have some time cleared off in your books, because he will talk to you for like hours about it. He loves them. And they're cool bikes. I actually rode one at one of our vintage races. But
and then there came Rolf Tiblin, and there was a Swedish really craftsman, Nils Edlund, that made a complete engine out of scratch and made the chassis also, but like a pretty cool engine, and he won a world championship on it.
Wow. Yeah. It's interesting how the different countries, like England was the powerhouse for a little bit, and then it was the Swedes, and then, you know,
even what drove
that?
England, the Swedes, and Belgium.
Yeah, because Central Europe then started coming together with
I think Belgium, one of the pluses for Belgium is that geographically we were located
in the middle.
In the middle, and we had a lot of races. Pretty much every town in Belgium had their own race, you know, like at some point of the year, like small races, bigger races. There was hundreds and hundreds of races in Belgium, and Belgium is only the size of Southern California.
Yeah.
You know, like from Santa Barbara to San Diego, that's pretty much it. You can only go about, if you went in a straight line, the longest distance you could go is 200 miles.
Yeah, that's crazy. Is some of that because of the sandy soil there? You were able to race regardless of the weather?
Actually, on the west and north side of the country, it's sandy. And then the southeast side, it's more rocky, clay, much more elevation changes, like tracks like Namur.
Yeah.
And so very big hills. And so within a short area, there was a lot of diversity in the type of tracks.
Which produce good riders as well, right?
Well, if you look at Belgium, the size, the population, everything over the years, how many times they've won the nations, the world championships, if you add them all together, the ride. I mean, Belgium has done a lot of damage in the world of motocross based on, Roger said, it's small. I mean, I lived there when I first went to Europe, but it's central because everything seems to be wrapped around Belgium.
You know, like the Swedes, they like to come to Belgium and be based in Belgium because they had a really long winter. Belgium had bad weather pretty much year round, but it was never really cold, you know.
Yeah.
You know, you would have a few freezing days, but not like Sweden or Finland or Norway.
Winter forever.
So they would come south. The English, either you raced in England or you had to come to the continent, get the ferry, and come to Belgium to go race in Belgium, France, Italy, Spain, Germany, you know. So we even to this day, a lot of the top European riders like Caroli and Prado, and they based in Belgium because there's good practice tracks and
a lot of variety within, you said, driving distance. So you can wake up and go hit a sand track, hit a hilly track, a clay track.
Yeah.
It's interesting, though.
So talk about your transition then from those early days into your pro racing. How did that all sort out?
Well, in Belgium, there was not a specific amateur and professional class. Even in the little races, there would be prize money. Small, but there would be prize money, actually.
For the amateurs?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Everyone was a pro.
Yeah. So everybody was an amateur. Or everybody
it hasn't changed in the U.S. Amateurs are getting paid big bucks when they go indirectly, but they get a pay cut when they turn pro.
So at the time, there was three classes in Belgium. There was a junior class. They call a senior class. A senior was actually an intermediate class, and then the international class. And then to go to the Grand Prix, you had to be top three or top four. It changed over the years. Top three or top four in your own championship to be able to get a visa to go to the Grand Prix.
In that international class?
The international class. Okay. So you had to do, it usually was 5 to 6 races a year in points that counted towards that national championship. And if you were not in the top three or four, you did not get to get the papers to to go to take part in the GPs. Mm.
So what year did you make that transition?
I was about to say, so you're saying it was harder to get a pro license way back then than it is now? Yeah. Now if you have a sponsor, I think you get a pro license.
Yeah, you know, in a way it was harder. It was totally dependent on your results also. And that's where you started having, you know, there was smaller countries like even smaller than Belgium. There was like Luxembourg, and so they did not have much of a championship or history in racing, although they had a GP there. But riders started taking their licenses there because, you know, if you could not get your license in Belgium for international for the GPs, you could get it over there.
Okay. So you go race their series.
Yeah.
It's like not that much talent to draw from at that country.
Yeah, but that was a way to get to the GPs if you were not like top four.
It's like they qualify for Loretta's here now. They go to 10 different regionals and then make sure they can qualify to...
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. So what year then did you make the transition up to GPs?
Well, I rode a GP in Italy in 65. Actually, I went with Joël.
Joël Robert.
I went with him and the sponsor, his sponsor, which was the CZ importer into Belgium. And I went just as a passenger to hang out and be with them. And the Belgian importer was a really good salesman and a good talker. And we were in Italy in Imola, where the road race track is also, and where there's a GP. They actually raced there this year.
Yeah, saw that.
Yeah,
man-made track.
And so we were there, and at the time the Czechs, they traveled with a bus that was half converted into a little
motorhome
and a half for the bikes. And they had an extra bike, the Czechs. And the Belgian importer, Marcel was his name, he convinced the guys to loan me a bike and ride. And I borrowed riding gear and, you know, and ended up riding the GP. And at that time, you needed a medical check before you could do your entry. And that already had been closed. So he convinced the guy to let me go to the hospital in town, get my check there and bring a signed paper from the doctor, and they would let me race. So I missed practice on Saturday, did the practice on Sunday morning, and I got 11th in my first GP.
500 GP straight into it?
Yeah, there was 250.
Okay.
250, yeah.
Huh, that's crazy. That's not how you want to start it out.
That is so interesting. So did you and Joël Robert, were you guys pretty close? I mean, that Joël, a six-time world champion for some people that don't know.
Joël was racing way earlier than me.
Yeah.
You know, he's only a year older, but he started racing a lot earlier. His dad raced himself, and his dad had a little dealership, little motorcycle dealership. And so he raced way before me, and then at the beginning, our connection was through the Belgium importer, basically.
Okay.
And and then after a couple of years, we ended up coming together to the U.S. You know, in '67 to do the first
Trans AMA stuff.
Yeah. At that time, it was, I forgot what it was called, Trans AMA. It changed
it
a couple
Trans
of times.
Trans AM, wasn't it?
It was Trans AM, then it was, Trans AMA first, then they call it Trans AM because the car series complained about using the same name.
Yeah.
So was he a good friend of yours then? Did you and Joël?
We got along and was funny. We got along fine, but he was a lot different than me, and he was Joël was super talented. You know, he really had an amazing balance. But when the tracks got really rough and there was a lot of work to do, then he was, you know, sometimes he would close the gas tap and make the bike quit in front of the grandstand. So then my bike quit, you know.
That's the old Larry Ward move where you hit the kill switch as you're going by.
Oh, yeah. Yep, my ignition is missing.
Throw your hands up in the air, wave at the mechanics area.
Flip your mechanic off.
We had a lot of good times together also, and traveling you know, the East Bloc countries, and we spent a lot of time in Czechoslovakia at the time, because that's where the bikes came from, and Joel was a big hero there because he won a world championship, and then another one for them, and he won three actually for CZ. And
is he somebody then that you kind of learned from? And
I watched him a lot on what he did as a rider on the track, you know, because he was so good, and he was smooth in his riding and good balance, and he on the mud races especially he was really, really good.
But you didn't adopt his work ethic, it doesn't sound like.
No, there was things we were a lot different in person, but there was a lot of fun times with him. And
Didn't I hear a rumor that he would, like, if his competitor was lined up next to him on the start line, he would stub his cigarette out on their, like, grip or their handlebar or something?
I don't know. You know, Joel, there's so many stories with him, and some are true and some are way exaggerated. But I remember we were in Australia one year, and we were at a racetrack near Sydney, and it was really hot. And we were hanging around after practice in the pit and all that, and Adolf Weil from Germany was there also, and there was quite a few of the European riders. And, you know, it was a big deal because it was the first time that a bunch of European top cut riders came out there, and so there was quite a few press people. There was also, the race was sponsored by a newspaper, actually, the main paper in Sydney. And Joel liked to always act like he was drunk or drinking or something. So he got a bottle of Johnny Walker and emptied it and put iced tea in it. And he would walk around the pit and go, you know, talk to the guys with the bottle in his hand and take a sip once in a while. And then somebody talked to the referee, hey, this guy is drinking, you know. And so the referee kind of came and checked and all that, and Joel would take a sip and work a little bit more. And now it's time to go to staging, and Joel takes his helmet, puts on his helmet backwards first, turns it around, you know, puts it on, takes his bike.
I like this guy.
Grabs his bike and go to kickstart it, and misses the kickstarter, you know, just like perfect acting. And he's tumbling with the bike. Finally, he gets a start. The referee comes running. No, you cannot race. You know, that is, you're drunk and all that. Finally, all the riders had to get together and say, no, let him race. You know, he's just faking it.
That's great.
Mind games. That's where it starts, right?
He was like a mix of the Dogger back before there was the Dogger, huh?
Yeah, yeah. The Dogger was... Yeah, he was.
Oh, we'll get to that.
Yeah,
I got plenty of questions about
that. That's on the
Dogger
timeline, huh?
So let's take me back to your first world championship. What year? What were you riding? What team? Like, how did that come about?
The first time I won.
Yeah.
That was, I just signed with Suzuki. I rode Joel and Gubos. They went to Suzuki in 1970. And I was racing, by then I was racing the open class, the 500 class. And so Suzuki, there was Joel, Sylvan, and myself, plus the Czech riders and some Russian riders on the CZ. So Joel and Sylvan, they left to go to Suzuki in 250. And at that time, Suzuki did not have an effort in the 500 class. And then, so they asked me to go back to 250 for one year, and I raced in 70, I raced the 250 class and finished third behind Joel and Sylvan. And then Suzuki came and they said they want to get in the 500 class and build a bike for that. And so I went to Suzuki, and I was the only rider in Europe on a 500 Suzuki.
Were all the Japanese manufacturers pushing in at about that time?
No, there was only Suzuki at that time,
okay.
and Kawasaki. Kawasaki was the second one to come with the GP effort with Ollie Peterson. And so I they sent me a 250 and a 500 bike to practice with and to do the local races with, which went really well. The big difference with Suzuki at that time, and I think it was like the Japanese mentality at the time, that if there was a problem with the bike, they would try to fix it. They would not try to blame you and say you were a stupid rider. You know, at the time, any European brand, if you broke the bike, which was very easy to do, all you had to do is over jump a big jump or land flat, you would either explode the front hub, bend the forks, or break the frame, you know? So it...
Well, yeah, that was another question I had about those bikes.
If you broke something, there was, oh, you stupid rider, you know?
It was your fault.
Don't you know that you cannot land on with the front wheel first? You know, you should land back wheel first, you know?
Yeah.
That's what they would tell you. And it was That's the crazy. Same for all the European companies. And the Japanese made a big change of mentality there. If you broke something, there was immediately they would go to the local post office and send a telegram message, you know, a cable to the factory, and with explanation what had happened,
yeah,
and that they needed to reinforce or redesign that part. And in a very short time, you know, they became dominant because they were open to take input and criticism.
Did you find you were able to then push that bike harder and harder than other guys were on other bikes?
Yeah, and the big thing, the big advantage I think we had on the Suzuki at first versus the European brands was the carburetor. You know, Mikuni was way ahead of any of the European brand carburetors. The bike ran way cleaner, and although the suspension was not the greatest, especially the first year, but the thing with carburetor so good. Mm. And
it's funny to see the power shifts, you know, between the countries. Like you were saying, it was like the British had the bikes and the riders in the very early stages of motocross, and then you saw that kind of
Belgium,
Swedes
with a fan, yeah,
and then you know, we started seeing the Japanese. Well, power
well, when were the Mako was the brand well, there for a little while,
yeah,
too.
The CZs and Makos, and there was then Bultaco and Montesa. And
basically, it sounds like the English brands were starting to fade away at this point, right?
Yeah, they it looked like they wanted to keep focusing on the four-stroke, and they made some, BSA made some bikes that were extremely light, you know. And it's funny because when we came with Suzuki, Suzuki's focus was on making the bike light, good ignition, and good carburation. And
more reliable.
And try to make it more reliable and all that. And the weight, but the weight was, they reached a very low weight because of good design. And they made parts smaller and they used a lot of aluminum, a little bit titanium also.
But they had titanium. They were using titanium parts back then.
Yeah, but
I thought it was later
on. The European companies like Mako, they complained a lot, and the British industry complained a lot about our bikes being too light and all that. But BSA made a bike that had way more titanium than any of our bikes. Hmm. You know, Jeff Smith at the BSA that was very close to the weight of a Suzuki, and it was
and
a four-stroke.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. Hmm.
They use a lot of magnesium. They had titanium rims.
Jeez.
Titanium spokes.
Jeez.
Wow. What's funny is...
titanium frame.
Don't you feel maybe things have slowly almost started doing full circle? Because, I mean, if you look at it, we could argue that the Europeans are now becoming sort of a bit of a dominant powerhouse in our sport. You know, we've seen the power shift from the English to the Scandinavians to the Europeans to the Japs. Now, do you feel like maybe, I mean, let's be honest, Husky's coming back. You know, you're talking about this, you know, when Sweden was strong.
With, you know, with KTM and Husky, we have worked very hard on getting the weight, you know, down and we had the lightest bike now, although we have had electric staff for a long time, and we are substantially lighter than the Japanese bikes right now on the production side. And even on the race team side, the factory side, we are lighter than the Japanese now.
Yeah, it's impressive.
And we are doing it with a steel frame instead of...
Yeah, there you go. And it doesn't break, right?
They all break, but, they... You can build them that nothing breaks, but then they're going to be so heavy
and over-engineered is the case. Yeah. No, I'm with you on that one.
Excuse me. Who are your biggest rivals back then during your world championship runs?
Well, for some time it was Whale, Bauer, Aki Onsen. Then came Mikola. Mikola was, over the years, the toughest guy, and he could never count him out. The guy was tough, and
I've seen pictures.
He is a scary looking son of a bitch. I was going to ask you that question.
Looks like you were trying to look a little like him. You're getting a little handlebar action going there, but you're not nearly as big or tough.
Not at all. This guy looked like an NFL linebacker in photos. I mean, you tell me, what was he? Was he intimidating in person too?
He was fit, and he never gave up. And I remember in '75 there was the biggest mud race I've ever been in. There was the Grand Prix of Italy in close to Alessandria, and I was leading both races. And with a couple of laps to go, the ignition just melted from the heat because there was so much mud and no cooling.
Not enough air going, yeah.
And Aki's bike kept going until the last lap, except the last straightaway, but the straightaway was uphill, and he carried his bike over the finish line and won.
Jeez. Threw it on his shoulder, or what did he do?
He just picked it up, and it was super difficult to walk.
Yeah.
And just carrying a bike through that mud was impressive that he did there.
That's crazy.
After the race, I was pissed off because my bike also broke, but it broke two laps before. There was no way you could do that. But I was impressed with what he did.
Yeah.
It was pretty cool.
That's awesome. So were guys really smoking cigarettes on the line back then? Was that a standard thing?
I never smoked, but I know that in road racing, and I saw it with my own eyes, the Barishin used to. He had a... Of course, in road race, a full face helmet, but he had a little.
Yeah, he had a cutout. I remember that. My dad showed me that when I was a kid. I was like, that is engineering right there. I don't know if Troy would approve or if modern day testing would approve, but that is pretty funny.
That's hilarious, man. Another thing that I always get a kick out of looking at these old photos, and I only can look through the old archive photos, but. The race rigs back then, what passed for a race truck? I mean, it was like a van, like a little Euro van or a pickup truck with a milk crate as a stand.
The van was already an evolution. Before that, like most of the English riders, they actually came with a small Morris pickup because they took the smallest pickup they could take, and then they would have to open the tailgate to be able to put the bike on, and the bike would still hang out of the back. But the reason they used to use that was because they had to take the ferry everywhere they went, and you paid by the length of your vehicle. So, but most of us we used a diesel car like a Mercedes 200D or 190D, and a trailer. And we usually made the trailers ourselves, and there again, the Swedes were the first one to make trailers that looked really cool, and they all unmade them, and they used the tail lights from a Mercedes and the little bumper from the Mercedes shaped them nice. And at that time, that was looking at a semi now. You know?
Feather light trailer.
Yeah.
Can you imagine pro racers in a pickup truck now? Like we've just gotten so used to have to have a semi or at least a nice sprinter or fifth wheel.
Well, it's crazy, what the riders, the support they get now. I see There's so many people that come in our trailer. There's one guy that comes and takes care of the goggles.
Oh, yeah.
Another guy that takes care of the knee braces.
Yep.
Then a guy that takes care of the boots. the rest of the...
There's a butt wiper. Gear. There's the
helmet. And
then there's a girlfriend.
Someone's got to shake that thing when he's done peeing. He's not going to do it itself. Yeah. I mean, you need people.
No, but so a paper towel guy. Just then
of
this.
Of course, you need a press person.
Yes.
And then you need
a trainer.
You need a hospitality
trainer. And a riding coach. And a life coach.
It's
some guys actually need a life coach more than anything.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy where it's gotten to. But... You know, many times I say it doesn't make it easier. It looks easier for the rider because everything is kind of done for him. But on the other hand, so they have no excuses anymore.
Yeah.
You know?
It's all on you.
Yeah. You everybody is there to help you and they film you. They tell you, hey, this place, you know, Eli is doing that. Dungey is doing this. Melvin is doing that. So you have all this input and all that. But then once you get on the bike, you're alone, you know, and it's still up to you.
Well, that's what we all love about motocross. I mean, I don't speak for everybody, but it's like you, no matter, regardless of the circumstances, when you're on the gate and it drops, it's you and yourself against those other riders, and that's
it. Like in my days, you know, if you made a mistake somewhere on the track, the chances your team would not know about it, or maybe... A month later, if they picked your shot up somewhere where you're taking the wrong line or something, but now the rider come in. If you made a mistake, you know, if he tells you, "Well, I was wide open in third gear," well,
yeah. Hold on a second.
Let me pull up the analytics. Hey,
can you go check it out, Ian? and he goes in the ECU and he says, "Oh, you were not in third gear. You were in second gear, and you were only 3 coasters full throttle opening."
Yeah.
You know?
Mwah, mwah, mwah.
Yeah. Did I say third gear?
That? Yeah. I'm dyslexic. Sorry,
that's funny.
I meant second.
Yeah. So we talked about it a little bit earlier, but managing race bikes back then, you know, it makes you appreciate the technology now, because if you look at the way Carmichael rode, or really anybody since him, you don't try to downside everything perfectly. You just, as far as you can go, as fast as you can go, when we're talking about motocross specifically, you couldn't do that back then. It was like you said, you had to manage the bike. That was a big part of racecraft.
Yeah, now it's pretty much the bike can do pretty much everywhere more than what a rider can do, what your human body can withstand. You know, like you can break your wrist now landing from a jump, and the bike is going to be perfectly fine, you know.
Yeah. I was going to ask, you know, we talk about the evolution of the sport and bikes and transition. How much involvement did you have on your own bikes? You know, when you look at some of the old footage, there were guys working on their bikes, making custom parts. I do know that you like to get on the machinery and machine parts.
Well, and when you mentioned Suzuki just sent you bikes, it's not like they sent over a technician and a crew to help you. So, yeah, if you were modifying it, if you were working on it, it was you, right?
Yeah, I was... From most of the riders, I was always a rider that was involved a lot with the bike. Before me, probably the Swedish riders were probably most knowledgeable of their bike and involved with the making of their bike, like Sten Lundin and Bill Nilsson, Tiblin. You know, those guys, they were involved actually in the making of their bike more than I ever did. Because they were one-off bikes, you know, at that time.
And you think that helped them to kind of develop a bike custom suited for their own style or whatever? Or do you think there was an advantage to that or not?
Yeah, of course. If you go back years, even between CZs and Huskies and Bultacos and all that, the bikes had much more personality in a way, you know. And a Husky was... maybe better on a sand track. CZ was better on a hardtack track. Mm. There was much more differences between the bike, the power band, the transmission, the chassis, the suspension. So it made for a bike to fit much better to one track, you know, than another.
Maybe almost even like with Formula One. You see a little bit of that today, but back in the day, you would see, okay, that's a Ferrari track, that's a Mercedes track.
Yeah,
that's,
but now and we all, of course, look at each other. If you take now, you can take the four Japanese and KTM and Husky. If you start measuring things, the important points on the bike, they're so close, you know.
It's almost like it's not really a bad bike this day.
No, the bikes have gotten so good. Yeah, it's amazing, you know, how good they've gotten. And that's why I don't even want to ride. A lot of the guys, they come and say, hey, you need to come and ride the old bikes, get together, you know, for vintage thing. I don't want to ride my old bikes.
I got to kick it. I
got to prime it.
Yeah, plus I want to remember them as what they were in their time. They were cool bikes, good bikes at that time. They were the best. But like compared to what they have today, like a stock bike is like 10 times better, you know?
Yeah. Stock bikes nowadays, I mean, like you said, it doesn't matter what we're talking about. You could say the worst bike in a shootout is still a really, really good bike, and it won't fall apart or break the frame or snap a throttle cable.
Well, it'll hold it. Racer X, we've gone away from shootouts because I just said it's pointless. They're all good bikes. Yeah. It's
rider preference, pretty much, is what it comes down to.
It used to be, well, this one has a ton of top end. This one is, you know... They were
this one actually finishes the race, so I'm going to pick that one.
Yeah, they're all good bikes now. There's not a bad bike, so that just seems silly now. Tell me about your training back then. You've always been known as a guy who's were very physical. You were very fit. You were determined.
I rode quite a bit on the motorcycle, and then I was lucky to hook up with in Brussels the top soccer team. Their top player was a motocross fan, and they used to come and watch me race in the early days already. And then I became friends with him, and I got to use the gym facilities and the chiropractor of the team and all that. So I got to learn a little bit early on, and that was a big advantage for me because I did not know so much. I did everything pretty much by trial and error.
Yeah.
And I did not have a dad that knew racing. I did not have a mentor that was knew about racing. So I went the slow road, but, you know, little by little, I figured it out.
Well, those soccer guys are fit if they're playing World Cup soccer. So,
well, like, you know, like Roger was saying, you know, back then that would be like, wow, we're going in a really great training program. Because, I mean, I can only imagine... What motocrosses, you know, if someone says, how do you become a better motocrosser?
Ride, run, probably, a lot of running.
I rode, and what I did is I rode rain or shine. I rode and did not care how muddy it was or so. I always rode, and I loved riding, and it did not matter where it was. Muddy or cold or whatever,
that's
whether
awesome.
It was. And I did ride a bicycle quite a bit also for training.
Road bikes?
Like a road bike, yeah.
See, I loved riding, you know, growing up as well. But when I moved to Europe, I still said, I really admire the Europeans who say, I just love riding. Because I'm like, it was cold or rainy or muddy, and coming from South Africa, we were allergic to mud. So if we saw the rain, it was like, oh, we'll call it. We'll race next weekend when it dries out.
I was from Arizona. We didn't have mud. It doesn't exist.
You know, when I hear you saying, oh, we would go out and ride in the mud, I'm like, man, that is impressive that you like, we love that.
And in my early days, the motocross season started in like at the end of March and finished pretty much by mid-September, third week of September. So then I would ride trials in the winter. And so that helped me, I think, to develop the traction control and
trials is big in Europe.
Were you pretty good at that?
I won a championship in 63.
Is that So yes. Yeah. You just say yes. All right.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, good answer. Yeah. Short and sweet, thank you.
Yeah.
Finishing claw.
That's awesome. We're same bike. What were you riding? What bike? What trials bike were you even riding?
I rode a Gilera with a homemade frame, and then I rode a Greaves. I got a factory ride from Greaves, but by then the motocross season started early, and when motocross started, I dropped the trials, and I was leading the series at that time. But I once I tasted racing I didn't want to stay home a week, and I wanted to compete in some motorcycle thing.
Yeah. Now, back then, I'm not too familiar of how. I know you said there were a lot of racing in many places during the year. I know when I went to Europe, I was surprised. Like in South Africa, if there's a club race or a race, there'd be like, say, for California, it'd be a race. Like, that was it. Then you go to Europe, and they're like, well, there's a race in Holland. There's an international in Germany. There's an invitational in France. And you're like, wow, it comes down to, it's not if there's a race, which one do I go to? Did they offer start money for you guys? Or was it a big pay? Like, did you make a lot of money from doing these extra races?
Yeah, because the GPs, I did not make money. Even if you won, you know, your prize money was so small. And many times, like the East Bloc countries, what you got was like their kind of money, which you could not convert. You had to spend it in that country.
Buy a souvenir. You get one of those hats you'll never wear again for your family, just to say I was there.
Here's a brick of government cheese. Good job.
Yeah, there we go.
You've done well. Yeah, comrade.
Like Russia, Czecho, Yugoslavia, East Germany. All those countries, you could not do nothing with their money. You could maybe buy something locally. Like in Russia, when I got a little smarter, I bought some like a samovar or things like that, you know. That the value in Czech, you brought crystal. But crystal, you could give to your wife or your girlfriend or your mom. But what are you going to do?
Or your wife and your girlfriend or... Oh, whatever.
I mean, you get a little sock. That's called getting cross-rutted. Sorry, there you go.
So were you getting championship bonuses from Suzuki or any of those or no? Nothing.
No, I had
how are you making a living?
In the international events, the events outside of the world championship, I got the show money. You know, like I would go. I got paid really well when I went to Italy or France. That's where and in Belgium also. And... probably made a couple thousand dollars a weekend.
You're talking about a couple thousand dollars back then?
Yeah, back then, yeah.
Oh, so we're talking like 20, 30 G's these days.
Yeah, no, that's
good money
back
big.
Then.
That is big. Hmm. Now, I got to add to that question. There's no cell phones, there's no email, there's no... Who gets in touch with you? How do they get in touch with you, and how do you sign the deal?
Oh, you need to do it ahead of time and by mail.
Oh, yeah, that's right. They used to be able to send letters. Yeah. That's right. I forgot about
that. It's hard to remember how we even existed before.
Yeah, I remember
email and text, right? It's wild.
And even finding your way, you know, when you look at today, it's so easy, you know. But at that time, like the East Bloc countries, you could barely find a map for those places, you know.
Well, I recently did the Farley Castle race over in England and trying to navigate through London. Forget it. Like, I would have died. I'd still be there if it weren't for Google Maps. My wife was just reading the phone and telling me which way to go, and I'm trying to shift with my left hand, running people over.
High-fiving cyclists as you go by.
Yeah, I was hitting them with my mirrors. Any of your world titles stand out for you?
Of course, the first one, you know, it was big. The second one was good because I felt I was... That's on the top of my game, and my bike, they made a lot of progress on the bike from the first year to the second year. My versus the competition, my bike in 72 was really outstanding.
Yeah.
And I was at my best, and at that time I could, I was not even worried about the stats.
Just came easy,
huh? Get them. I had the fitness, I had the bike, you know.
How long were the motos?
At that time, 40 minutes plus
two laps?
Plus two, yeah.
When I did the GPs, I think it was the last year in 2000 that they had 40 plus two.
Yeah.
It's a long race, especially in the sand. Yeah. Especially in the sand. Yeah. Oh, my goodness. In Belgium or Holland, you have to be, you actually have to really learn to understand sand because you couldn't ride like that, otherwise you'd be done. But they were long motos. <That's laughs> You had to learn really quick how to be fit.
So you remember that feeling of like everything just clicking, the bike's perfect, your confidence is, you just know you're going to win. I had like little glimpses of that in my career, like a weekend or here or there. You got championship runs. I'm sure you were on that same thing. I mean, what is that difficult when you're working with riders? Like, you know what that feels like and you're trying to get them there and you're trying to put all those pieces together, but it's so tough. I mean, everything has to come together just right. to have that mindset?
It's a lot, a combination of a lot of things. You know, of course, the bike has to fit you. You have to see yourself. You know, need to see yourself there and have no doubt. You know, no doubt that in of yourself or that something could go wrong or something.
But that's so hard. I mean, I struggle with that my whole career. It's probably what held me back between my injuries and then that creating doubt. You could tell yourself, I am going to kick ass. This is my weekend. I'm going to win it. And when you get up on the line, you're like, no, I'm not. This guy's better than me or, you know, my fitness isn't there. You know. You can't lie to yourself in your head.
Yeah, I think it starts from the beginning, you know, doing your homework.
Yeah.
If you have done your homework, that's already one thing that you don't have to worry about. If you know you've done as much as anybody on next to you on the line, and then you need to, once you pick a bike, if you make a deal with whatever brand it is, you have to be convinced that your bike is as good or better than any other bike out there. You really have to believe that. And that's why it's a big mistake for a racer to sign a contract with a company if you don't like the bike, if you don't think that is the best bike. Mm-hmm. You're much better off going race for free, but with the bike that you really want, then you're going to make it back in results and bonus money and, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
So we've been talking about racing back then. I've got a random question I have to ask. Did you have tear-offs?
Actually,
and if not, when did they come about? When was
actually,
that cool?
Actually, the first guy that thought about putting an extra lens on was Adolf Weil, the German rider. Yep. And I saw him do it, then I did it, and we just used a spare lens.
Yep. Tape it on?
And tape it on. I would. There was on the goggles I used at that time was a Carrera.
Yeah.
There was two little snaps, and I would shove in another lens in between there, and then taper it, and put a little tab of tape.
So you got one tear off.
Yeah, the one, and then
one very stiff tear off.
Yeah,
yeah. But it was 100% improvement, you know.
Yeah,
yeah, exactly. Yeah, and now you have two chances. Yeah.
Your second tear off is this, just like wiping your jersey across your goggle. That's funny. Give me your least and your favorite circuit when you were racing back then.
I really like Namur, and in Belgium it's a very different track. It's kind of the Monaco of F1, you know.
I had the luxury of racing it once, and it was insane.
I walked around it when I went. I did a supermoto race out there, just past that. Yeah. So we stopped, and I looked around. I couldn't even imagine that there was a track there. It seemed crazy.
It's sketchy.
I watched my first Grand Prix there when I was in 58 when René Baton won, and he won the World Championship that year. Maybe that's what made it special also for me. Mm-hmm. I had ridden my bicycle to that place, and it was about 50 miles from my house.
You rode 50 miles on your bicycle?
Yeah. And
was that your warm-up?
Did you pack a snack?
I don't even remember.
He just hit
that.
In and out on the way, man. But
that was really cool. So happy to have seen a GP, you know. I still remember the noise of the bike in the woods because there's a lot of big trees.
The echoes real loud.
Echoes, yeah. And it's up all the walls and the citadel.
It's insane. It's insane. I mean, I'm glad you got to go see it. I remember when I went there, I was just like, I couldn't believe it. I remember, how about that step down in the trees that guys started doing later in the years? Yeah. I mean, it's insane. It's literally like dropping off a four-story
like cliff.
You just turn out of a blind bend. There's a few feet, and then you've just got to go for it.
And then you cross a road, like an asphalt road.
Yeah.
Past the pub.
Yeah, by the pub.
I remember that place.
And then in the U.S., I really liked Unadilla. Mm. Unadilla was... because at that time it was completely natural when I raced. They only raced at that time once a year. There would be
the 70s and early 80s.
It'd probably clog up your radiator.
I should have brought some pictures. I have some pictures from Unadilla. You cannot believe how rough the track was at the time. Oh, big ditches. And
we're going to hold you to it. We want to see these pictures.
I would love
we're going to get some pictures. We're going
to
show the people about Unadilla.
We'll post these up on our social on Whiskey Throttle. What's our Instagram? At Whiskey Throttle Show. We'll post some of these up if you send them to us. I'd love to see
Twitter one. Twitter one's a tongue twister.
And then, let me get me started on the Twitter one.
Italy was had some cool tracks also. France had cool tracks. But Italy was special because the fans were, and still today when you race there, the fans are so into it, you know.
They are
They're motorsport fanatics.
And they always like the tracks with a lot of elevation change. And some cool tracks there, like Fermo or Sanatoglia.
Are there any of those tracks that are still around today? I know you said Imola, which is sort of come back.
Yeah, it's come back. And it's
not the same, not exactly not the same track, but the same, the same, yeah, same, same region. Wood,
Cingoli is still around, but there was no GP but anymore. But and Fermo is still around.
We went to Cingoli.
What about your least favorite? Is there a track you just hated?
What I hated was when the tracks were dusty. It didn't matter what track. If it was dusty, I really, really pissed me off. And I was the first one to go complain to the promoter and trying to do something about it.
It's dangerous.
Well, thankfully you didn't grow up racing in motocross in South Africa in the early 90s because you would have hated every track. But what a truck was in not in use that day.
There was 1 year in Namur was particularly bad. Etterbrook in Luxembourg 1 year was really bad. Actually, the year that Dave Nicol, Kurt's dead, the year he won there, was so bad. After the first guy, you could not see nothing. Mm. It was really bad.
So literally, if we came down to the keys to the moto, it was get the start.
Yeah.
Keys
otherwise,
to the race,
get the start or you're screwed and you're screwed.
What was your rivalry or interaction with Bob Hanna?
Bob, Bob was...
I could tell by that there's a little to this...
It's funny, when 1 year I came over and he had won, I don't know, 13 races in a row or something, and he was waiting for me.
Like, literally?
Yeah, he was ready for me. And we were in, I remember one event was in Ohio, mid-Ohio.
Uh-huh.
And we were staging to go on the track in practice, you know, first lap of practice. And I'm one of the first guys to exit, and he's right there by me, you know. And I'm doing my first lap to check the track, and he's coming and bumping me and rubbing his front wheel against my leg, and you know. It really helped me because when I came over, it was after the European season was finished. You know, we had all our national races, our national championship, the world championship, and then I come over to the U.S. So by the way Bob was and the way he spoke and all the things he did, it helped me to get my motivation again, you know, get going again for a new series. And
so he pissed you off, basically.
He would either like intimidate the hell out of you or piss you off.
That's
right?
What I say. It sounded like he motivated you.
It motivated me. And Bob was a tough racer, you know. He was really tough and he was fit, you know. He would not give up. And we had, you know, we only overlapped a couple, 2 or 3 years. But we had some good battles.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think we have a lot of respect for each other.
Did you guys have any interaction off the track, ever getting into any...
No.
Yelling matches, arguments. Did he ever? I mean, he was notorious for lipping off.
Talked a lot, but many times he backed it up. So he motivated me, but you know, I had respect for him. And one thing, what he at one of the races, it was St. Louis in Missouri. At that time, we were all in box vans, you know. And
step up now.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
And on the back door of his van, he had a speedball, you know, on
speed bag, a speed bag.
And Suzuki had made this life-size cutout for the dealers of me, and he had one of those plastered behind it, you know, on the van. And a lot of the fans came by, you know, in the pit, and they look at Bob, and he was walking out there. And said, I remember that.
Yeah, that's funny. Yeah. That sounds like Bob Hanna.
Yeah. But then I when I was at Honda, we hired him to come and join our team, you know. And I have to say that Bob was a real team player once he came on our team. Mm-hmm. And he was good to work with.
A lot of times I feel like competitors may not like each other when they race, but then when they get over the racing thing, they realize they have a lot in common, or yeah, there's things they respect, yeah, about each other because they've worked similar ways to get to that elite level.
Yeah.
And you keep seeing that, so yeah, it's pretty cool.
Well, yeah, Bob was one of those guys, I think, a lot like Bradshaw, where he just, for him, he had to hate everyone he raced against. He couldn't be buddies and go have a beer with you like, say, Fro and Jeremy. It was like he had to, in his mind, say, that's the enemy, right? I mean, that was how he motivated himself.
Yeah, probably, yeah.
So after you're done racing, then it's like, yeah, that's all gone.
Yeah, we you know, we're friends now, you know, yeah, but he, Bob was a real racer, you know.
Yeah.
He was tough, and it you know, to race against people like that, it's a good feeling, you know. Maybe you're pissed off at the moment, but it brings the best out of you, you know. It makes you do better also.
And, yeah, and absolutely.
It's special to race against tough yep, guys, you know.
Yeah. Yep.
It makes it feel everything that you earned more rewarding, I think.
Right. Kind of like, similar to Heike Mikkola, right, yeah, back in Europe. Yeah. To me, they were kind of like similar, yeah, very intimidating, pretty brash.
Yeah.
Bob was a little more outspoken and obnoxious, yeah, but yeah. What's your best memory? If you had to just take one memory with you from your racing career, what would it be?
That's a tough one, but I think overall it's seeing the world and the opportunity it gave me to meet a lot of special people, and the opportunity to have made a decent living at my hobby, basically, you know, at doing what I like to do. And I, you know, I'm an old man now, but I still really enjoy what I do, and I feel really lucky.
Yeah.
You know, so.
That's awesome. All right, I want to transition a little bit going into your Honda days, and I want to talk about what was that decision like to step away from racing. I know it's tough for a lot of guys, and if you're able to stay in the sport like you did, that can help make that transition easier. What was it that you made you say, all right, I'm done racing? Was there an incident or an event, or was it just like something that came on the off season? You said, I'm good, I'm done.
No, when I went to Honda, they gave me the option to, they gave me a 3-year deal, and they gave me the option to race 1 or 2 years and then go on the management side. And I'm good friends also with Eddie Merckx, the bicycle racer.
Yeah.
And Eddie...
Tour de France champion,
yeah,
multiple times. Yeah.
Yeah, he's by far the most successful bicycle racer ever, you know.
Yeah.
So Eddie retired a little bit before me. I think it was 78 that he retired. But I feel that he waited a year or two too long. And I saw the struggle he went through, you know, by still
trying to hang on.
Still try to hang on. And he was not happy, you know, for a couple of years, two, 3 years, and it took a while for him to get through it. And so I told myself, I'm, you know, I cannot do that. And but I still enjoyed racing so much. And in when I got hired by Honda, my main job was to be a development rider, basically, you know, developing the ProLink at the time.
Oh yeah,
yeah, and So that we had two young riders on the team. We had Malherbe and Graham Noyce. And Graham had won the year before. And so I worked a lot on suspension development on the bike and also on the engine, but mostly on the chassis. And at the first race I raced on Honda, I was in Payerne in Switzerland.
Yep.
And I was leading the race, and the shock gave way, and it stayed fully compressed, you know, about three quarters into the race. And
oh, you guys had so the same issue with Dungey.
That was a air shock.
I'm just, yeah. I had to throw that in there.
Yeah. But so that pinned me back. You know, we did not score a point that race, and I did more things, and then I was still competitive in then towards the end of the season, like the next to last race was the Belgium GP at Namur. And at Namur, I had trouble with the throttle sticking. It was a big mud race. It rained a lot, and the throttle was completely
that's
stuck.
That's not the place where you watch your throttle
sticking. I was just thinking in my head, and knowing that place and seeing the throttle was stuck. That's the time I'd come by and turn the fuel off or hitting the kill switch.
There's trees and there's structures. I mean, yeah, this is not the place for you.
Wavy mechanic.
Yeah.
In that race, I should have won because I was a couple of seconds a lap faster on that track than Malherbe or anybody else.
Namur seems like a track that if you're just dialed in, you can be not half a second or a second. You can be
two or three, four
seconds quicker than the other guys. There's something about that place that I've seen great riders just kill it there.
And I knew how to set up my bike for that race, you know, and everything went good until that happened. And then the next race was the last GP of the season at Etterbrook in Luxembourg. And the championship by then was going to be between Lackey and Malherbe. And I was, you know, a teammate with Malherbe and friends also. And but I was also friends with Brad.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I was good friends. Brad stayed at my house the first year he was in Europe. He told me that.
Yes. He actually mentioned that.
Brad and Laurie, and they were, you know, we were close. So, and the Honda guys, they told me, you cannot, you know, you need to help Andre win the championship. And so I went to them, and I went to both of them separately and told them, listen, today, either, you know, you have to ride away from me or I'm going to ride away from you. You know, I'm not going to get involved in the battle of the points between the two of you. And fine. And then I was able to win both motos easily, you know, going away.
That makes it easy on you. Like
so then we're on the podium. And then I started thinking, and I said, you know, maybe this is the best way to finish.
Go out on top.
Yeah, I had fast time in qualifying, fast, and you know, easy win in both motors, and so I decided there. Okay, guys, you've seen my last race when I was on the podium.
You made the decision right then.
Yeah.
But that is actually kind of crazy when you think about it, because so many people to this day in any sport, if they end that season that way, they're like, next year I'm coming back, I'm getting another title, I'm going to be better, fitter, stronger, faster. It's a very select few that can literally. I haven't heard too many people that have.
I worked
with another guy, Carmichael.
Ricky and Dungey. Yeah. Dungey, when he went out after his championship.
You obviously wore off on them, but how? It's got to be some. I think for a lot of people, they would think, how do you walk away when you just went and dominated and you just said it felt easy? How do you walk away when you're that good? Like, it's crazy.
It's difficult, but I
well, you said you saw Eddie.
That's what.
Do you think that really helped you decide? I want to end on a good note. Good note.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, and then Dave Arnold was working for me at the time. He was my mechanic, and then we came back to the States, and the following week We were running the team together, you know.
Wow. So they hired you kind of on the spot as a manager?
No, I had a three-year deal with Honda, and, you know, they knew that they wanted me in the bike development and in managing the team, and Dave became the team manager, and I was...
bike development.
I was the team overall advisor and still test rider also. I did a lot of test riding still, and Dave and I, we complemented each other well. I thought we got along good, and we did a lot of crazy things at first with Honda. You know, we cut up some frames and changed things, and Japanese would come and they go, "What did you do? How come you did not tell us?" Well, we have been asking for this for months, you know, and we just wanted to try it. But we actually, both Dave and I, we developed a really good relationship with the top people in Japan on the engineering side and the race team manager. The big boss at that time in Japan was Mr. Miyakoshi. And at that time, racing was run out of on the R&D. There was no HRC yet. That was before HRC came about. And then we, you know, at the end of the year, there was talk about the nation and the U.S. could not put a team together. And then we had five riders. I said to Dave, at that time it was five riders for the team.
Yeah.
And then Dave and I, we talked, why don't we do it together? We take all our team, you know. And
was that 81?
Yeah.
That was the first year we won?
Yeah. And then Dick Miller from MXA, he became supporting of it. At that time, Bill Ray was quite actively into motocross and all that. So they Bill Ray gave us support, and the guy in Belgium that was the distributor and boss for Bill Ray Europe, a guy by the name of Arthur Kuhn, he got all excited about it too. And then, you know, we were fortunate that we could win and put a string of many years together.
Many years.
Yeah.
Was it 13 in a row the first time around? Until England won in 94, right?
Yeah.
That was Roggenberg.
Roggenberg.
When our friend Albertine hit a deer.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
I was a kid.
That was a wild.
Bit of a stalker, a wild fan myself, but I watched racing.
I always wondered this. Was there ever any bitterness with Belgian fans or Belgian friends that you had that you weren't managing their team?
Actually, I had offered the Belgium team to help them. And they said, no, we are set, you know. And I don't know. By then, I was already spending a lot of time in the U.S. I was more in the U.S. than in Belgium. And they did not think they needed me, and they thought that they thought that there was no chance that we could win the nation, especially at Lommel, you know, with five young riders that had never been in Europe even. Mm-hmm. But that was pretty cool.
Yeah,
I could imagine. I think it'd be a lot tougher for them to go and try and win there now. I mean, we saw a little bit this year, but
it's been really tough the last. We had some bad luck. Like in Italy, we should have won if it was not for the Japanese rider landing on Anderson. I think we would have won that day. Yeah.
But what do they call it when a Japanese guy like bombs on your head?
I don't know. I don't want to go down that road.
After the finish line.
Yeah, I saw that. I just can't remember what that's called. It's like I think there's a shot named at
kamikaze pilot.
I don't know. Yeah, something. Anyway. Tell me about those years at Honda. When did HRC start?
82.
Okay, so the very next year.
82 was a good year.
Those years at Honda were just through the 80s.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Special.
Were incredible. You guys had these just works of art bikes. You had the best riders on the planet. That had to just been a cool era to be a part of it.
Yeah, it was good and fun. The boss of racing at that time, Mr. Miyakoshi, was like a dictator, you know. But he wanted to win so bad. He was always reading this Chinese war war books and about war strategy and all that. And he equated racing like exactly like to war, you know. You have to have the same approach. And and he was really good also at getting budget for the race team. He was good inside the company to get what he needed. Mm-hmm. And
that's always important. Because nowadays, everyone wants to make money, not spend it.
Yeah, and then he expected a lot from everybody on the team. You know, he would get so pissed off if something went wrong. So,
was he based out of the U.S. at American Honda?
No, he was based in Japan, but he came over once in a while. And I remember one race he came to. It's after practice, and there's a spare bike under a tarp behind the van. You know. And he went to look at it. It was actually Jim Felty's bike, you know, with O'Mara. And there was a little bit of rust on the pipes. Were not treated at that time. It was just bare metal, yeah. You know. And there was a little bit of rust between the frame, you know, on the side
back
of the frame,
pipe, yeah.
You know, and on the pipe. And he threw such a fit, like it was like scary. You
know? Oh wow. Yeah.
But then after the race, and you won a race, and we had a party. He was party like party
he was a
like
Troy Lee of the party. Just yeah, made exactly. sure it went wide yeah. open.
Yeah.
And when we say wide open, sometimes we literally mean there's something being held wide open.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. Troy, I'm sure Troy could give him a run for his money.
Yeah. Troy would fit in really good at the KTM parties. I've never seen people go so bananas as at those big KTM functions.
Yeah,
they're jumping bikes in a room this big. They'd set up a jump, and guys would jump off of a stage.
Well, that kind of started in around 2000 when we just were given free rein. Well, they didn't lock the door to the production line, and we went and grabbed 50s with that much oil and that much gas, and we rode them till they seized, and we parked them and grabbed another one, and then it just became a thing.
Yeah.
But the Euros do love. I feel like in Europe, it's work hard, and then when it's time to cut off, it's you go hard too.
Yeah, and you know, as we go back in time, people it took more time. You know, now a lot of the riders today, as soon as the race is over, they look the first flight. You know, and some of it is. Because guys like Aldon also, you know.
Yeah, he doesn't let you hang around.
Aldon is so strict with the guys that, you know, sometimes it's... I feel like sometimes it's a bit too much, but overall...
We're also seeing riders' careers being shortened, in my opinion.
But you can't argue with his track record either, though, right? I mean, that's the problem.
If you look, I think if you take the last 18 years, 14 of them champions have come through him, you know.
That's staggering. That's not even realistic. Tell me about, you know, that Honda, that era. You guys were making things that, I mean, those were the era of really true works bikes.
Yeah.
Was there anything that you guys developed that was super cool that we didn't get to see?
Well, I don't know. You probably heard about the automatic bike.
I've heard stories.
That bike was, there was some definitely some nice things about it. You could do like a long corner slide, you know, and you're
always in the right gear.
Always in the right gear. You would not have to stop and shift, and the bike do this, you know. Mm-hmm. So that was cool.
Why didn't that ever go further?
I think cost of production and there was also a little bit of weight, and it was at the time the Supercross was becoming more and more important already, and you know it was. Supercross was probably the least
necessary for I was going to say an automatic. I could only imagine going off a triple face. Yes, ball. It shifted three quarters of the way up the face.
We had a 125 with a rotary valve, but instead of the rotary valve being on the same axis as the crankshaft, it was between the transmission and the cylinder. So there was a bevel gear. Driving it from the crankshaft, and if this is the engineer, the disc, the rotary disc would turn
went
this way.
This way? What was the benefit of that? Gyroscopic?
The width of the engine, because if you have the...
Oh, yes, that makes it more streamlined, right?
Yeah, and it it was... The intake was going into the middle of the engine, you know, instead of all from one side. And then if you have it on one side, you had the carburetor sticking out, or you needed a elbow.
A boot, yeah.
And then you lose power because of that, because of the...
Airflow.
Hmm.
Ram Air is the best. Direct flow.
That's crazy. Was there any...
We also had two-cylinder motocross bike, 125. We tested that Yucca Valley on that bike.
And again, weight was probably the issue?
It was really fast, but not so good on traction and not a good bottom end, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was one of those, took a little while to wind up almost.
Yeah.
But like a big bang engine.
Top power was impressive for the time.
Like on a dyno, it probably screamed, huh?
Yeah. Then we had a double ProLink also at some point.
Wow. Was there ever any riders on that team that you wanted to get that you didn't?
Yeah. There was Barnett.
Barnett?
Yeah, Barnett.
The bomber.
Yeah, the bomber. We tried to get him in the early days, but then Bob actually talked to Hannah and said, "Hey, I have an offer from Honda, but Suzuki's, and they really want to keep me." And Bob told me, just go back and ask them for $1 million, you know. and then Tosh accepted it.
He took it?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
But we Bob was probably like, damn it, I should have asked him for that.
We tried hard to get Barnett.
Huh.
Yeah.
Wow, that's crazy. Seems like you guys had every top rider you could have, but yeah, I guess Mark was the one that one that got away.
And we tried with Wardy also, but Arnold and I we felt that we should not push too much with Wardy, because we felt that he was really a Kawasaki kid, you know, and we wanted to have a little bit of ethic. Respect.
Yeah, a little etiquette there between teams. That is interesting too, because it depending on when you hire a guy and sort of how that plays out, it can look like it can go bad for the manufacturer, right?
Yeah.
It can look like, well, you just bought the best guy,
right?
Kind of like when the basketball team just hires all the best players. People get pissed that they're winning. It's like, well,
if he can do it, why not?
Yeah.
I mean, at some point, I mean, you know, not
but it can be bad PR for a team.
There's always a risk. I mean, you know, you went through that with Carmichael. I mean, you know, when you were at Suzuki, that's a risk. When you got a guy that's expected to win, the bar is here. You know, guess what? There's a lot more chance if he doesn't do quite... I mean, even Jeremy, you know, MC in the 90s, when he made the switch from Honda, I think that at that time, not saying the Suzuki wasn't that good, but because of what happened with Jeremy, I think it sort of made people think, ooh, is the Suzuki really that good?
It pushed us back, and, you know, Jeremy should have won, you know. Jeremy...
It was really, really close on several occasions. It seemed like some bad luck that year.
It was not just bad luck. There was more to it than bad luck. There was... first of all, Jeremy... I got a call from Jeremy, like... I think it was the day, it was either the day before or the day after Christmas. I said,
I remember hearing it was right around that time.
I have some issues, you know, with the Honda guys. They, you know, I don't want to stay there. Can you fit me in? And I said, shoot, you know, this is an opportunity, you know, that...
Doesn't come knocking very often,
And I knew Jeremy well, because we were the ones, Dave and I were the ones that took him and then gave him to Mitch, you know. And he did. That's the year we put the 125 outside, and Mitch did the peak team. Mm-hmm. And so I worked with him. We worked with him and Swink, and you know, at Simi Valley on the test track and all that, and we saw firsthand how good that Jeremy was, and then, you know, he had all the success with Honda later on. Then when he wanted to come our way, I said, I have to find a way, you know, but you can imagine with the Japanese company asking them the week before the first race to sign this new guy.
Yeah, seven figures probably of bonus pay.
Actually, Jeremy was really reasonable in
but the, you got to factor in parts and bikes and mechanic.
Yeah. Lack of testing.
So I did not even have a bike, so I told Ian, I said...
Ian Harrison.
Can you get Greg's bike ready for the day after New Year? And so that now there's 5 days, you know. Well, who is it for? I cannot tell you. So the day before we go to Germany, he had a little track right by his house of the 15.
I remember that.
The 215.
215, yeah.
And so he prepared the bike. We went there, and Jeremy rode it. We made the deal, and he started. But then Jeremy and Jack, they wanted Wyatt to be the mechanic.
Wyatt Seals.
Yep. Wyatt Seals. And we really did not want that, but we did not want to lose the opportunity of getting Jeremy. So we went along with it. And then in the season was barely going, and then he falls madly in love, Wyatt. And all he could think about is what's going to see his girlfriend. And he would show up late. The bike would not be done. We had to have somebody else work on the bike. There were so many mistakes on the bike. Ian and I, we were so scared to watch Jeremy. Things would fall off the bike. Plastic would fall off sometimes and during practice and things like that. And
Jeremy wasn't... Did he know about all this stuff?
I don't know. They believe so much in Wyatt that they... until a certain point, then we got his old mechanic back. Who was his name again?
Randy, was it?
No, not Randy.
Before Randy.
Bigger guy.
Skip?
Skip.
Skip. Okay.
And then finally we brought in Skip. We convinced Jeremy, hey, this cannot go on anymore. You know, you guys, his mind is somewhere else. And you know, you're going to get hurt with this thing. And then when Skip starts working on the bike, he found out that on the clutch actuator, there's two bearings that on the little shaft that goes into the engine mm-hmm. that pushes the cam, you know. And he only had put one in it. So we could not figure how to... We would go to practice with him with a practice bike, and the clutch would work perfect. And his race bike, he would always have some complaint, you know, that the clutch would not disengage completely. That's one thing. Then the next thing he found out is he always wanted to adapt some Honda pads, and he used Honda throttle cable. Then one day he comes and, hey, come and look at this. Is this normal? And throttle is wide open on the grip, and the slide is only three quarters
it's
wide
not
open.
Not all the way open. Oh my gosh. This is Skip who had found this?
This Skip found this because Wyatt was the guy working on the bike, and we would be on the dyno and all that. Jan helped a lot on the bike, and we made good power. We spent a lot of time at Mitch, and the bike had good power. But his race bike was never the same as the practice bike that we tested with also.
So at what point in the season did you guys bring Skip on? About halfway?
A little bit past halfway. And then, and then on top of that, in Charlotte, Jeremy had a flat tire. Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, at the party, Jeremy stepped in a broken glass bottle and cut his heel open pretty bad. So and
it was the worst injury of his career.
And we
cut your foot on a beer bottle.
And we lost the championship by 7 points.
Yeah. That's crazy. I didn't know that about his race bike issues.
Yeah,
I'm sure you guys were trying to keep that quiet for obvious reasons.
Yeah, this is actually the first time I say it openly, and
You heard it here on the Whiskey Throttle Show first, folks. Blowing Wyatt Seals out of the water. No, he's a great
Wyatt,
guy.
Wyatt's
a good dude. He was distracted. Many a good man has gone down.
We call it pussy whipped.
Yes.
I mean, once you get PW'd, a lot of guys, it's like, duh.
See what you girls do to us?
Many a good man has gone down from a woman.
Yeah. It's like the Titanic.
All right. That's a crazy story. I want to ask if you've got a good Ron Lachine story.
Gee. Besides getting arrested in Japan.
I mean, yeah.
We all know that.
There's
one.
A lot of them, but.
There was one of the nations in France. And so it was.
What year is this?
I think it was 80.
I'm trying to think when he was
86. It was the French one.
He was on a 125?
At Villers-sous-Écot. I remember the track. And we stayed at this little motel. And there is, across the parking lot, there is the restaurant. I tell the guys, okay, we going to have dinner this Friday night now. Now Saturday night. On Friday, for some reason, he missed our group. I said, Saturday, you better be ready for dinner with the team tonight. Huh? And no problem. We all in the restaurant. We already order food. They already start bringing food. No Ronnie. So I go to the hotel, go knock on his room. No answer. That's so weird, you know. Where can he go? He didn't have a car or anything. And so I go back to the restaurant, ask around. Nobody has seen Ronnie. Go back to knock on the door again on his room. So finally he opens. He opens and there was by the night table, by the bed, bunch of empty beer bottles. Other side of the room, more beer bottles. I said, Ronnie, what the fuck are you doing, you know? You're supposed to be at dinner. What are you doing here? Oh, I'll be there. Just a second. I'll be there. So finally he shows up. We all in... And RJ and I, we threatened him that we're going to kill him if he is not ready for the next day.
Yeah.
So we are just about done with dinner, about ready to leave. And all of a sudden, no Ronnie. Ronnie is gone. I come out, cross the parking lot. And there's this car come. And I see it's Ronnie in the car. with a girl driving the car, and there's Ronnie. And I stop the, you know, go in front of the car, stop them. What the hell are you doing, you know? Oh, RD, don't worry, it will be a few minutes, you know. I'll be back, you know. That.
And, it'll be less than 2 minutes.
So
quicker than my lap time.
Then the next day, unbelievably, he rode like a champ. We told him, Ronnie, you're dead if you screw up the team, you know. And we had been winning, you know, every year since 81, and then. But he rode unbelievably good.
Have you ever seen a guy that could do that? I mean, just the shenanigans he'd pull and then just deliver on race day.
Yeah, he couldn't always do it, but he did it more than once.
Yeah.
Yeah. He did it also at when we had the Supercross we only raced there one time a couple times in Pasadena.
Oh, the Rose Bowl.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Probably because he just liked the name or something. Yeah. Like, oh, Rose Bowl, I want to win. Yeah, give a rose.
Yeah. Yeah. He had this huge cut on his thumb, right where, you know, you hold on the handlebar.
Yeah.
You could actually see the bone. Mm. And say, Ronnie, take care of these things. You need to tape that better, you know. I'll be okay, Andy. I'll be okay. And that he wrote like he had nothing wrong.
So
and the thing was nasty.
So he was like the original Ronnie Mac. Just yeah, didn't the real, care. Yeah, just
the real Ronnie Mac.
But he was winning races. Yeah. That's the only difference. Anything that you... what are your thoughts on the production rule of 86? I know in terms of manufacturing and race teams, that was huge. It affected Rick Johnson's move. You know, he came to Honda knowing that that was coming in and thinking maybe that was a better move for his career, which probably proved to be true. Did that really change things as a manager for you?
It changed things for me because Honda at that time asked me to spend to be more in the U.S. Before that, I was going back and forth all the time. I was going to the GPs to work with Andre and Romans and Noyce, and I was basically every other week I would go to Europe and back to the U.S. back and forth and back and forth, and then they asked me to be based full time in the U.S. and only go to Europe, you know, once in a while, so that was a big change, and then I got involved with the testing of the production bike because we knew we were going to have to race the following year. And as a race team, we were really, really against it. We really got bummed out, you know. You know, we had, in 85, we had those beautiful bikes with the low gas tank. And,
yeah.
And they were really, you know.
Coolest looking bikes still ever built, I would say.
For their time, it made a lot of people huge Honda fans. Like my dad, when I was a kid, he was a Honda fan for multiple reasons.
Everything
on
that bike was so nicely detailed, and you know there was a lot of thought put into every bolt, every screw on that bike. And then at first, the production bike, the guy in charge of production was a really difficult guy to deal with, and
there's always one prick in every group.
We really, Dave and I, we had so many, many arguments and fights with those guys, and then they made a good bike. Our bike ended up being good, and we still kept winning and all that. But it made the production bike more expensive, also. And the race bike not as cool, you know.
Yeah. Do you guys feel like you went backwards in performance if you took your 85 race bike?
For sure.
Wow.
They did a good job with the production bike, but that like from 82 to 85, that factory bike was
unreal.
They were unreal.
Yeah.
You know.
So, I've thought about this a little bit. I was a kid, grew up in South Africa where we rode what we were given. If something broke, if your handlebars broke, you maybe took something of your BMX bike or you made it happen, you know, especially if you weren't, you know, wealthy. Going to Europe and then being on a factory team like KTM and winning the world championship, I remember just thinking how incredible the change was from that production to a factory bike. In Europe, that was allowed, but in America, they have that production rule, and from what it sounds like, it's almost like they implemented it at that time, and it's never really changed. I have my opinion, but what do you think, in your eyes, you know, you talk about the coolness and this and that. They say the production rule was to help the privateers or the little guys, and I've always said, you know what, the big guys on the big teams with the big budgets, they're going to win anyway. You can help the little guys. It doesn't really help. Do you think the production rule has really helped the little guys or helped the sport, or do you think it's taken away from the sort of F1 factor or the MotoGP factor of our sport? Because
he just said it made the production bike more expensive, so right there, that sucks.
Well, straight away, but that's to the consumer, which
right.
is a good point, you both said. But I'm saying, from a racing standpoint, do you think it took a little bit away from separating it from... You know, a guy on the street goes, "That's my bike," but wow, look at that!
Yeah, the definitely the cool factor, you know, is diminished. Diminished a lot, and it depends with what kind of people. You know, so, some people, I like to go see racing and cool race bike. I like to see them look at a MotoGP bike and
it's unique
or a Formula One car yeah. or you know high end technology.
I'm with you on that one.
I'm
sure.
a fan of that also. And there's more people like me, but there's people that don't pay attention to that so much, you know. But like I said, it made the production bike more expensive. But it made them a lot better, also.
Yeah,
and for the factory bikes, I don't think the factory production based bike. I don't think it made them a lot cheaper because now you have to walk around the rules, mm-hmm. and you know you're
spending more money to get those incremental changes and improvements, huh?
So
it's almost like NASCAR, in my opinion.
There's some pluses and minuses, you know.
You know, with NASCAR, they try to keep these rules to keep everyone the same. But you got teams spending hundreds of millions on a wind yeah. tunnel change or something to gain a hundredth of a second. It's still the same sort of the big guys will succeed more than the little guys, which comes back to the big guys get the drivers or the riders they need.
But as far as results, who wins and who doesn't win, I don't think it has changed anything because the
cream rises to the top.
Yeah, the top guys. Motocross, Supercross is still so much about the rider that, you know, it would be extremely difficult to make a bike that is so much better that,
yeah.
you know, that a secondary rider could win with it and right. and be the best guys on the bike that is not quite the best.
Yeah. Tell me about why the switch to Suzuki and how that came about.
At Honda, you know, for a long time, Dave and I were directly in communication with Japan. We did not have to do anything through American Honda, other than dealing with the photo shoot and the press PR requirements. Anything about the bike was we communicated directly with Japan, and we were able to get a Japanese guy as our liaison. His name was Mr. Kezuka. And we were able to make him the middleman between us. So what we could not express in Japanese or in English that the Japanese understood, he was the guy. And we would tell him something, and the guy was really cool. He would run with it and fight like hell to get what we had requested, you know.
Yeah.
And that was a really good combination. And then a little like a year or two after the production bull came, they changed the channel and we started having to go through American Honda stuff for everything, and then the communication was not the same anymore. It was becoming more and more difficult, and after a couple of years of two, three years of that, I was getting so frustrated and all that. And when I stopped racing, I worked 13 years straight with Honda and never took a vacation or, you know, I took a day off here and there, but I never took a break from racing after I stopped racing myself. And I thought, you know, I don't want to put up with this. I need a break, you know. Mm. And so I traveled to Europe back and forth quite a bit and spent some time with friends and did some things I had not done for a long time, and then Suzuki. I got contacted by Sylvan, who I was good friends with, and he runs Suzuki in Europe. And Sylvan asked, "Hey, you know, you need to come back to Suzuki. They need your help in the U.S. to get going again, and they want to talk to you." And at first, I was not so interested. And then they asked me, "Well, come to Japan and come to the factory. You know, come and see us. We want to talk to you." So I went to Japan, and we got in this meeting room at the factory, and they brought all the guys that had worked with me when I was racing for them, like the team manager from the time, the mechanics that had worked for me when I won the championship, and so on. There was like about 15 people in the room, and it was a really cool feeling. And Roger San, we need you. And
they were giving you the full court press.
Yeah. And And then Sylvain kept pushing on the other hand, and then Sylvain said, well, you know, that he had, at the time he was talking to Albertine that had won the championship on the Honda, and Honda had promised him some things, and they did not come true like they had promised, and then he asked, you know, if you do this, so he wants to go, his dream is to come to the US. If we do this, he races in Europe 1 or 2 years, and then he comes with you in the US, you know. And then I ended up taking that deal, and then that's how Albertine got here, and how I got back to Suzuki.
Yeah, and you had a lot of success there, and it seems like from Honda, Suzuki, and then when you went to KTM, the key to that success was a good direct link back to the factory. Like you were saying at Honda, when you started having to go through all these channels, it slows down your improvement. Yeah. But when you can just talk directly with Japan, say, hey, this is what I need, and they do it, you guys were able to make really big gains, and that translated into titles everywhere you went.
Yeah.
Those early years at Suzuki were a little tough, though, getting that bike right.
Well, when I came to Suzuki, back to Suzuki, I went to, by then they were in Brea, and I asked them, okay, where's the workshop, you know, where's the race shop? we don't have a race shop yet, but we're going to get one, you know. So we walked in the parking lot at the first year, and they had a department where they took care of the magazine bikes and a little bit of testing with Tosh and all that when they had some new products coming in, and the marine division was there also. But we had no workshop.
I remember you guys being at Pro Circuit quite a bit, and I remember.
Yeah, and then I made a deal with Mitch so we could work with him on the dyno, and I spent a lot of time there at Mitch on the 250 and at Bill's pipe for the 125.
Mm-hmm. I remember those days well.
yeah,
I was gonna say that might ring a bell.
Yeah,
Bill's.
Well, that was the little bit I worked with you, my time there at Bill's pipes, and had a couple good races and one good run at that championship, and rough round in Minnesota kind of knocked me out. But how significant was it for you getting Carmichael under the tent there?
Of course, it was you know, an awesome opportunity. It was kind of a second chance at what had happened with Jeremy, you know.
I was just about to say, similar situation where...
Yeah, very similar. He got crosshaired with some of the management at Honda, and it did not happen as late, and it did not happen as suddenly and quickly.
Yeah, he made a decision.
It was a much earlier decision, and we talked about it... the first time I talked to him about it was at Daytona Supercross.
It was pretty early.
So it was pretty early. That's the first time we really talked about a possibility to join us. So we had with him we had time to prepare. You know, with Jeremy we had basically. Between Christmas and New Year.
Yeah.
You had like a week and a half or something crazy, huh?
Yeah, less than
that. I was going to say,
about 5 days.
But now, you know, you talk about that, and I'm just someone that looks at things that seem to repeat themselves. And this is my opinion. Do you think Honda were drinking maybe too much of their own Kool-Aid after your guys' dominance? Because... to me, it seemed like after the 80s, in the 90s, that's when you started seeing things change a little bit in the latter 90s. You know, Jeremy had his issues. Like you said, Carmichael, he, from what I've heard from him, he wanted to leave Honda. Valentino Rossi, you know, different sport, but he wanted to leave Honda. Is it, like, I feel like there's this, you know, they got to the top together, and then once they got to the top, it seemed like relationships didn't end or follow through. Is there something that maybe you could help us?
You know, it at every company, you know, there is, if you win a lot, the tendency is to think that, you have it all figured out. And it's the bike, not the rider, maybe. Yeah, and it works the other way also. If a rider wins a lot, they think that it's all them and that
nothing to
do with the bike or with the team.
You can go in anywhere.
Yeah, so there's a little bit of both, and Honda is a big company, and a lot of people that get involved in management are not necessarily knowledgeable of what it takes to win races and what motivates people. And if you're part of a big organization and a successful company like Honda, it's easy to, become overconfident also.
Well, those are also names that I mentioned that were... Let's just say they were, I don't want to say big egos, but they were big personalities at their time in their sport. Do you think maybe it was a little bit of a battle of like Honda were like, no, we're the big guy. And the rider or the athlete was saying, no, wait a minute, I'm the big guy. Do you think it was maybe it got to a point where the guys that were the best riding for Honda, maybe it was a little tension of who actually was the superstar?
Probably, you know, as a rider, with any good rider, any top rider wants to feel wanted and wants to feel a certain importance,
sure,
you know.
Yeah.
And if you manage a team and you don't realize that, then that's a pretty basic rule, you know, that you should respect. But there was fantastic people at Suzuki, and I got frustrated with them because management changes so many times, and then they put somebody in charge that have no clue about what it takes for racing, and they only look at what they did in the past and think that they can repeat it, but without having any knowledge of what it takes, you know. At Suzuki, we had a team manager in the mid-70s that was a fantastic guy, you know, smart, hard worker. His name was Mr. Yokuchi. At Honda, we had Mr. Miyakoshi that was very similar in personality and, you know, guys that they knew they wanted to fight, they worked hard. And I think with Honda, when Mr. Honda Soichiro, when he passed away, I think it took away something from the company also, you know, because he was such a
driving force.
Yeah,
over there,
such a driving force, such so racing minded, so technology minded, he wanted to win, and he always kept the motorcycle as the foundation of the company. He never wanted to forget about that.
Yeah. Mm. As they say in America, staying true to your roots.
Yeah.
I have a question. This got sent to us on our Instagram page, and I thought it was just a great question. When you were at Suzuki, hindsight being what it is, what would you have done differently with Travis Pastrana?
I tried everything with Travis. You know,
whip it, don't flip it. You know.
I tried everything. One year we were in Minnesota, the national, and he had several concussions.
That was 0-1 when we were battling.
And he quit in the race. Basically, passed out riding. Basically, you know. And after the race, we're trying to talk to him and say, Travis, you need to take a rest, you need to take a break and all that. But they had a commitment for the next day to do a jump. You know, I think it was maybe San Francisco when he
Gravity jumped. Games.
Oh,
back
Gravity
then.
Games. And so I said, promise me, don't go to the to the games. You know, don't go and do, you know, take a rest and all that. And his dad was there, Robert, and all that. And yeah, and all that. Sure enough, 2 hours later, I found out they're on the way driving there, you know.
I remember seeing an article where they asked you if you knew, and you had kind of vented about the whole thing.
Yeah, it was. But Travis is such a cool person and so loyal, you know. There's such a good side on the guy that he's...
You couldn't get mad at him.
It's so hard to get to... You can get mad at him, but he would just apologize and you know, he was always so super nice. And it with Travis, it was never about the money. It was, you know, he wanted to... And then he made so good money from ESPN with the X Games and all that, you know, I don't know how much he made, but he probably made more money than most everybody else.
Oh, he's laughing in the bank right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, no, so. Listen, we say, you know, I asked that question as though he was this unsuccessful racer. He made his own path. It just wasn't the traditional one.
Right.
And I would bet you he's probably made as much money or more than guys winning titles today. I mean, I don't know. I'm not into his bank account, but that Nitro Circus
thing. I'm pretty sure
if
you take an income through his career, I guarantee you he's the highest grossing athlete of our industry.
It was just so frustrating during that time because he was so good.
There was so much possibility, you know.
And you wanted to see him live up to that. And
trust me, I had to hear about all his possibility when I came here. I was the one told I had no hope in hell of beating him.
Yeah.
And that really starts you know, weighing on your mind.
Sure. All right. Well, that's that question. What about Reedy there? I felt like he was a good fit at Suzuki, but he didn't last too long. He kind of came and went. Did he burn a bridge there, or what happened? Because I would have said that he looked as good on that Suzuki as he ever did.
He did. He did, and I think he liked our team. But we paid him really, really well when he was at Suzuki. And for some reason, they did not really want to negotiate for, you know, and... Steve was mainly talking directly with Mel at that time about the finances, mm-hmm. and then it never even got close to coming to. As far as I know, there was never really a number and said, you know, if we take this, we need this number. If you offer that to us, we stay. We were at the Nation, and he rode the Suzuki at the Nations, and after the race, he was wearing a Monster head on the same day that he raced the Suzuki with Rockstar.
Is that right?
So
did he... He seems like he's got a history of kind of burning some bridges as he leaves. Was that his agent, though? Just negotiating?
It was... It was Steve that was negotiating with Mel on the financial side.
Steve Astafin, right?
Yeah.
Interesting. I just always thought he looked so great on that bike. That would have been a good place to stay.
It was his best outdoor season ever.
Ever, yeah.
And he did okay, pretty good in Supercross too.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. All right, so tell me.
I think he got third that year in Supercross.
But he looked good.
Yeah.
He didn't win the title. I can't remember who did, but... He looked great on that bike.
Yeah.
09 was Stu, wasn't it?
Stu, I think, yeah.
Stu was amazing that year.
07 and 09.
So you switched to KTM. Walk us through that. What happened there? And was that a big gamble for you? Suzuki was at least a team that you knew had a history and you had a history with.
Yeah.
This seemed like more of a reach.
Well, I got frustrated with them again and it was in 2010. We were leading. We had won Supercross. We were leading the outdoors, and I did not have a new deal in for the following year for 2011. But Dungey had the year 2011 was in his contract, and he started asking me, "Hey, have they renewed your deal yet?" And now. You know, but I think I don't see a problem. I'm sure they're gonna talk about it. And after some time, and as the season was going further, I asked them, "Hey, I want to know for the next year. My contract is finished at the end of this year." And we'll talk about it. But they kept stalling, and then finally said, "I said that I need to know." And they said, "We don't know yet. We're waiting for, upper management in Japan and all that." And I used to be able to go into Tanaka. Tanaka was the president at the time in Brea, and I used to be able to walk in his office, and if I had a problem, I did not abuse it, but if I had a problem, I used to go see him.
Yeah.
Now, all of a sudden, he wouldn't even want to see me because he did not want to face me, And so finally, I told him, I need an answer. And I still thought the championship was almost finished, and then we were going to go to Southwick we were going to win the championship, and I thought maybe they're going to come to Southwick and win the championship and celebrate
thing,
and make a new contract. So we win the championship, nothing. And KTM had been asking me already several times before, and I always thought, I'll never work for KTM. I don't see myself there, but then when that happened, then they called me again. I said, "Well, what do you have in mind?" And then I listened to what they had to say, Pete was very quick to come up with an offer, and then I told Suzuki again and said, "Hey, I need to know, or I'm going to be leaving." And then I still could not. Then finally they made me an offer for 10 months, and I thought that was
10 months.
Yeah, I thought that was a slap in the face, and then I called KTM back. I said, "Okay, I'm coming."
Were you nervous about that? I mean, I know it's hard to look at it now.
And just so people know, he said Pit Beyer, that was a, GP winner, he was like the bridesmaid or third many a time, but Pit Beyer had good credentials as a racer. He was known as the Pit Bull, just hardworking German guy. He had a unfortunate incident in the GPs while racing. Was paralyzed, moved into a role at KTM, and just helping the people that don't understand that. But yeah. Pit Beyer was a guy that actually I watched race, looked up to, moved into a role, and then really started aligning good people with a company that was on the way up. So I'm just interjecting and trying to insert this. Yeah. And then, so he called Roger, and that's where this went.
Yeah, and then I knew it was not going to be easy. At that time they never won in the open class in the 450 class, and they.
Well, yeah, going back to that year, those bikes were not super great. No. They're not the bikes that you have today.
How was Phoenix 02? How did that work out for you?
That didn't work out great. How was your year on the 250?
You had two bikes. You had two by the time you left Phoenix. You went there with one.
I went with two. Yeah, that was a good night. Yeah. I did some math.
Yeah,
what about you? That 252 stroke spit you over the bars, a handful of times. Handled like a shopping cart.
I was going to say, that's another show on its own, but the PDS didn't work in Supercross. No, that's the short story. Yeah. And
so Yeah, no, it was better a little bit by the time you came in, but it still was not...
You made some instrumental changes to the company. If we just cut to the story, you won't say that bluntly, but I know you made some really big, you said, "I think need to go here there."
I definitely, when I came, I said, we need this and this. And
you cracked your whip.
I met with the boss of R&D, Philip Habsburg. And they told me, "Hey, better when you meet with this guy is not not easy,
Like most scientists.
And he is a good guy. He's very sharp. And the first thing I wanted them to change was some of the design on the swing arm and rear axle. And they start questioning me, and why this? And we think this swing arm is fine and this axle is fine and all that. And, you know, they were arguing with a lot of things that I was asking. Then I asked him, I said, tell me, how many Supercross have you won? And then there was big silence, you know. And Ian was with me. Ian was... He thought they were going to kick us out. But they came around and they did a lot of the things that we asked them to do, and they did it really fast.
And that is one thing that KTM, I can say, I mean, I'm not that old. I've not been around nearly as long as you have, but KTM... To me, I think what's helped them in modern era over the Japanese is just what you just said, the fact that they could move quickly. Because they made a lot of quick changes when you went over there. And it seemed like 6 months when you were there was like 6 years previously.
Well, they're a much smaller company than these Japanese brands, so they're able to make those quick changes, build these half-year bikes, the factory editions like they do. And
well, that's, I think, what he helped install, really.
But what is cool at KTM is that almost everybody rides.
They're passionate.
Even a lot of the girls that work in the office and all that, they ride for fun on the weekend, or they ride a street bike, or they ride a trail bike or something, and it's amazing how many people there ride.
That's awesome. Yeah. Well, when it's a passion, I mean, all those other big companies have cars and generators and marine and yada yada yada. KTM is bikes.
Yeah. How quick are you gonna get to work on your generator?
I don't.
It's gonna take you a little while.
I don't make good time. I mean, get to listen to a lot of podcasts.
I was gonna say your phone will be fully charged, but you're not gonna get there in a hurry.
And just, you know, you've got now that you've kind of stepped out, I'll sort of fill in a hole here. You mentioned Ian Harrison came over with Albie at Suzuki. He was Albie's mechanic at Suzuki.
Yeah.
Won a Greg championship Albertine. There, with you guys, was at Suzuki the whole time, came to KTM with you, has been there the whole time.
Can I interject real quick?
Worked for Dungey, and now he's taking the reins, for those who don't know, as a new team manager.
I have to ask, as a kid that grew up, huge Albertine fan. He was the guy that made us feel like a kid out of Africa could take on the world. You took him under your wing. I know there were frustrating times. Please just tell me, as in a summary, with Albie, like I said, was my idol, my hero, and someone that I know you worked with a long time. How did that all work? And at the end of the day, it worked out. But tell us a little bit about the highs and the lows.
Yeah, the beginning of Supercross was always painful because he ended up getting hurt, and Greg had a huge heart, and everything was about commitment, you know.
But he told me he thought maybe he came in a little bit cocky or arrogant, like, I'm a world champ, I can beat anyone.
He definitely had that feeling that he could beat anybody. He had confidence was. He was not lacking confidence, that's for sure. And, you know, there's a few times in Supercross that he should have won that he threw it away on the last lap or something and all that.
But, I remember a lot of those.
Yeah, but Greg was a really cool guy to work with, and he should have won the year before even, but... again, he fell in love in 88.
It's a common thread 98. Here. There's a common thread here.
In 98, yeah.
Yeah, a little whoopsh.
And he was head over heels, and because he should have won in 98. And then he finally did it the following year.
I felt
year.
The pain with you, trust me.
Yeah. Yeah, Greg was cool, and it was cool that he brought Ian with him because he is one of the best people in the industry. And
Ian obviously was a huge, I mean, Greg's always said Ian's been a huge part of his career. Like, he even said, you know, in Europe when he was a young, you know, teenager figuring it out, like, Ian and him were like wingmen.
Yeah.
You know, and to see the fact that they're still tight and now where Ian's at, and you're, it's a funny story. You know, the old saying, there's certain people that come and go, and there's a lot of people that stay, and it's neat to see. But I always wondered, because with LB, I felt like when he came here, people were like, he could win the Nationals.
Yeah.
And it was win races, got hurt, crashed, made mistakes, did this. Next year, won some race. It just seemed like a groundhog until he got there, which was great.
1 year in Houston, there was a quad. And
I remember the crash.
He jumped off.
He decided to try to do the quad, and everybody was struggling doing the triple there. But he had so much confidence. He bent the bike so hard that it broke the engine.
I remember that crash.
It broke the engine cases.
Went like this and the jumped bike over. Just, yeah.
The only thing left on that motorcycle that was reusable was the rear wheel. Everything else was bent.
Jeez.
Everything.
The most memorable Albi crash, while we're talking about it, for me, I think it was Orlando. He got off to the side of the track and he gets bucked off the bike.
And he does it.
And it's still on. And I got hurt that night. And I'm in the hospital. Swink comes in with a broken collarbone. Chad Pedersen comes in with a broken wrist. They come wheeling Albie in. It was like a party in the ER. Hey, every time they'd roll somebody else in.
The ER crew are like, what happened? We're like, it's Supercross race.
Yeah.
Can't move my legs, but I'm good.
That's standard Supercross party. Well, listen, we've kept you a long time. I appreciate your time. I don't want to let you get home here, but... tell me about the new role you've kind of slid into. I know it seems like you didn't want to just stay home and twiddle your thumbs, so you wanted to be around a little bit doing something.
Yeah, I'm as busy as ever or more, and so it's really not much different in reality. It's more on paper, you know. I have responsibility now over Bolt Husqvarna and KTM, and also over the WP, our suspension company. So I have to sign a lot more
paperwork.
Less
traveling? So are you going to be at all the races again?
No, travel is not going to change, and it's just that I'll be a little bit less in the workshop and more in the office, but. I'm trying to force myself not to spend more than half a day. Once the season starts, I plan half a day in the shop or at the track and the other half day or office.
Okay. Yeah. So you're not retiring. That's all a bunch of bullshit.
No, I'm not
retiring. All right.
I have to ask, because I've been told by people close to you that said, I said, I thought Roger was going to retire after he got KTM on the map again and, you know, this and this. And people close to you have told me, work doesn't kill Roger. If Roger doesn't work, it'll kill him.
Yeah, that's the way I feel.
All right, so you answered the question. So it is true. Yeah. You are a workaholic.
Yeah, I like what I do. And
it keeps you alive.
I
appreciate that. I think a lot of people can.
I love racing. You know, I like to be around competitive people and I like to see good racing,
we're pretty competitive. I mean, especially in like cornhole toss and all that. So if you want to get aggressive cornholing, whatever,
ping pong,
we got you afterwards.
We can get some three wheelers and do like pedal three wheeler races around here. We can battle.
We'll get Troy involved. He might set off some fire extinguishers. Maybe I don't know, burn a hole in the roof. Who knows?
So there's something that I always think about that I laugh. When I was managing Troy's team for the first year, and I think it was my second weekend, maybe Phoenix or something, and I'm up in the team manager's tower, and I'm kind of new to the etiquette. You know, you guys have all been up there for a while. You got it all figured out. And one of our guys, Chris Blos, was up front in this heat race, and he's battling for the win. And I'm just excited. I was so excited. I got my shirt, arm out of my coat sleeve, and I'm swinging my sleeve like this as he's going by. And I look over at you, and you're just laughing at me. You thought it was, you're like, look at this rookie over here. You know, calm down.
Yeah. I've been up in the tower a few races, but I kind of felt the same way.
That's pretty funny, man.
Like way overexcited.
We're not going to talk about the MXDN. We've beat that up to death everywhere about our shellacking this year.
Well, hold on. I do have a question, though.
Go ahead.
I mean, we've seen... I'm sorry. Everyone's laughing. Thank you. Thank you. We've seen the pendulum swing. We've seen the Europeans dominate. We've seen it kind of do this when you were involved. And then I feel like the pendulum, if we're talking motocross, purely motocross, yeah. I think the pendulum has swung.
Yeah, clearly, you know.
That's I don't just mean just based on this year's donations. I'm not saying Eli Tomac and Marvin and those guys are not good enough. I guess my question really is, with the Europeans focusing primarily or purely on motocross, supercross to me is a bit of a land, point, squirt the gas. Momentum, gear shifting. Do you really think that the motocross powerhouse is going back to Europe? Because that's what I think.
Yeah, it's...
I may offend a lot of people right now, but I really think that's the way it's going.
That's obvious.
It's true, and it's obvious, you know, but it also is affected by the type of tracks that we, like this year, you know, the Red Bud was not a normal Red Bud, you know.
Are you talking about the national or the nation?
The nation. The nation Red Bud was very, very different, not only by weather.
The amount of sand they brought in. I was there.
And it looked. I think to the defense of our riders, they were going there with the mind that they were racing Red Bud.
And it was a lot different.
Red
huh?
Bud. It was like going to Europe, you know.
That's exactly what I said. I said, this looks way different.
Yeah.
But with that said... good riders need to be able to perform anywhere, anytime, any place. You know, I mean, in the 90s, let's just throw in McGrath. Supercross specialist went to Europe in European conditions and won in his category.
Yeah.
Like, that is a huge deal. That just solidifies yourself as a racer, period.
But in the 80s and part of the 90s, because of Supercross, our riders had developed... more technique, you know, and now a lot of the Europeans have learned about that, but them focusing all year round on outdoors and with really fast tracks and all that, it's very difficult for an American-based rider that they're so focused on Supercross and that don't race any of the Europeans until the end of the year one time, and after a 5-week break also, when the Europeans raced the week
Supercross
before.
And
There were some things that, like, our guys had never had to deal with that metal start grate with mud. We used it in Supercross, but pushing up to a muddy gate and figuring out how to keep your tires clean, how to clean that off, we'd never had to really deal with that. I know you made a comment about you could turn your back to the track and tell when an American guy went by.
Yeah.
Their RPMs are, you know, thousands of RPMs higher than, the Europeans would go by and it's lugging. Those are little subtle things that I think just
because no one lugs in Supercross. I mean, in the whoops, that's it. Mm-hmm. You don't lug it anywhere else. Yeah. You're right in the meat of the power, and you set the bike and the gearing and the gearbox and everything. And I know my dad said it at one point when I moved to the States and was really focusing on Supercross. He said, "You've lost your corner speed." And that was the one thing that people complimented me on. I mean, we were teammates. So I think you probably noticed that. But are we getting that point now where motocross, you got America, which is supercross. I mean, I don't think you could say, oh, well, the Europeans will come and wax us on supercross. I wouldn't say never happen, but it's not going to happen for many, 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 many years. But in motocross, I think it's taken away and, now we're on this.
It's definitely dividing into two sports like this, where they're very different disciplines.
That's the hard part. It's like a trials guy and a flat track guy. Yeah,
it is.
Because you all won. I mean, Jeremy did the, I'm a supercross guy. Reed's doing it now in his later years. But for a normal guy, if someone came to you, if Cooper Webb came and said, "Hey, I want a Supercross only contract," you wouldn't say, "Okay."
No, I still think for our industry in the U.S., we need to keep outdoors at a reasonable level. You know.
Agreed. Let me ask you one question. Where the hell are we going? Last question. Where is motocross, supercross going? I mean, electric, four strokes. You've seen this swing in your lifetime of four strokes to two strokes, now back to four strokes. The electric movement has sort of been pushed in a little bit.
Back to two strokes.
where do you see it going?
I think it would be good to have more two-stroke classes lower level.
Amateur level. You
know, amateur level, even maybe pro level. The main class, I think, needs to stay what it is, a four-stroke. But it would not be bad to have a 250 two-stroke class or a 125 two-stroke class, even for pro riders.
Is that realistic or reasonable to ask of the manufacturers that currently don't make those bikes anymore to say, hey, you need to bring these back? We need not a price point bike, but maybe an entry level bike.
I think if you organize the races, if the promoter makes the races, I think it will come.
Creates the
demand. They can manipulate it how they want. Yeah. No, I agree with that.
All right. Anything else you got to ask? I want to let this guy go. We've held him here forever. He's going to start throwing punches at me.
Just moving forward. So you got your new job. How long are we going to see you around? In life. Don't want to ask that. I know that's a little too personable.
As long as the guy upstairs.
Yeah. As long as he keeps you around, you just going to keep traveling?
As long as, like I said, they keep me healthy and that I can hang with the younger guys and not be a burden. As long as I can help and make a difference, I like what they do. And
well, I look forward to seeing you in first class next year.
I'm sure he's got enough miles.
Yeah,
I'll pay for mine.
Roger, anything you want to say to the fans out there?
I appreciate a lot of the fans that that enjoy the sport and that give me the respect that they do and I love to have had the opportunity to work in this country and you have a great country and not everything is perfect but there's a lot of good things here and you should realize that it is one of the best places in the world.
Amen.
Well said.
Well, Roger, you're an absolute legend in our sport, and I know I speak for everybody when I just say thank you for your passion for the sport, your commitment to it.
Thank you.
And thank you again for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Roger DeCoster, everybody.
Yes. Thank you.
Hang tight. We're going to be right back. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll return to finish up the show. All right, welcome back. Welcome back, everybody. We got a couple things here to wrap the show up. The next segment we've got is our Decal Works Last Call. Now, when I'm building one of the things I do at RacerX is build our garage build project bikes. Super nice perk of the job. Like, I get to build these beautiful race bikes, ride them for the year, and then turn them in all beat up. And one of my go-tos when it comes to aesthetics is Decal Works. These guys are so dialed. You can tell them, give them a kind of a concept or an idea that you want, these colors, this kind of look, and they're on it. They hook it up. I mean, these guys are just money. Professional, they're quick. And they also sell plastic. So if you don't want to go through the hassle of mounting the plastic, the graphics on the plastic, you just say, hey.
If you're mounting plastics, you're doing something wrong. But anyway, if you're putting the graphics on the plastics,
right,
is what you're saying.
That's what I mean.
That is an issue on its own. And I know that people do not like doing that. But mounting plastics is something that we don't approve of on this show, Pigree. But
do they do that in other countries?
But
I don't know.
If you want to put graphics on the plastics,
okay.
Yes, those guys kill it. And I do know that when we have people order graphics through our store, they always say, oh, can you put it on? You tell them, oh, it's going to cost that much. Oh, bro, I could do it myself. We always say, please do. Because it's going to be a bubble, and they're going to bitch and say, I don't want to pay for it. That's what we deal with at the shop all the time.
So. Well, it's hard not to make bubbles. It's hard. You got to be good at it. And these guys are good at it at Decal Works. You can buy the plastic. They'll mount your graphics onto the plastic, send you the plastic, and all you've got to do is bolt on the plastic, okay. And it's ready to go. That's where I'm headed with all that. Anyway, check out my guys at decalworks.com. They're dialed. You can buy one of the graphics kits that they have already made. Or
mount it.
Or custom build your own. It's kind of your call. One more thing I want to touch on here before we move on is the NBC Sports Gold Package this year. Have you heard about this? This thing's launched for Supercross this year. Similar to what they had at the Nationals last year, where you could buy the package, watch everything on demand, live, online. $74.99 this year to watch the entire Monster Energy Supercross season on demand, and you're getting everything all day long.
From commercial
the very
free.
first timed qualifying at the beginning of the day all the way through the main events.
Basically, get also the added bonuses. Like, just I know from the outdoors, you get behind the scenes stuff, extra stuff. And what's great is nowadays with technology, you can put it on your big screen on your laptop, fast forward whatever you don't want to see go, and then even if you miss it, you can just go and start it. And
yeah, it's all on demand. You can maneuver through it as you want to. That's what's nice. The Supercross schedule, there was some people that weren't stoked on it when it came out. I think it was just bad. The way the information was given was wrong.
The delivery
was bad. Every race is going to be on NBC Sports, which is the second biggest sports network. A lot of people didn't have Fox Sports 1, 2, or 3, or whatever they had. It's like the Ocho. But everybody's got NBC Sports, right? So you're going to be able to see these. There are a handful that are tape delayed either later that day or the following day. That's just one of those scheduling things that's tough. That's why this is great. The $74.99 not only gets you those additional time practices and all that stuff, but you can see everything live right when you want to watch it. So check that out. And then for an additional $15, you get the Nationals as well. So for $100, under $100, you're getting every second of everything that's going on all year long.
It's pretty simple. If you're a moto fan, you'll spend more than that going to a bar, drinking, and watching and having dinner one night than you would for the whole season. So put it in perspective.
That's right. One night drinking, and you've just spent that money. Sober up, you drunk bastards, and just buy the Supercross package. All right, we're going to get to the Decal Works last call. This is where we've got people, random people. I don't know these people. They're making prank calls, and we've got recordings of them. This is, I think, Barry Goldberg. He's trying to buy a quad. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
All right, Donnie, let's hear this guy give it a whirl.
Glad it's Barry.
Order. Yes, hello. I'm looking for Joe.
Yeah, how can I help you?
I've got calling about the quad you have on Craigslist here. It looks like a Spider-Man quad.
Okay.
I am calling. I'm very interested. I was looking at a motorcycle, but my balance is not that great. I thought, maybe four wheels, you know, is more my speed. But, you know, I got a budget. I'm on a budget here, and so I'm looking at this quad. I thought it's pretty good. What can you tell me more about it here?
Are you planning on using it on the street?
Well, you know, I see the guys popping wheelies and shit down the street, but I'm more like maybe trails, you know, a little more low speed. I'm not crazy like that. More trails, yeah. Probably more dirt.
It's not street legal, so it's for off-road use only. The better one that we have is actually for kids, so I don't know if that's going to fit you.
Well, I'm pretty small in visual. I'm only 5'6", you know, I'm only 120 pounds. I probably fit on it just fine. What do you think?
No, I think it's going to be too small for you, man.
Oh, no, this is terrible. You don't have anything for, like, a bigger adults?
No, we only have kids' ATVs.
And these are made in China, I see. Is that right?
Yeah.
You guys ship to Syosset? I mean, Syosset will be in New York.
Oh, no, we only do in-store pickups.
Oh, shit. I'm going to have to drive all the way out there for this, and it's for a kid. I'm going to look ridiculous. You guys sell helmets with these?
Yeah.
Now, what about I come out there, you give me a ride around on it. I sit on your shoulders or something. We look silly. We go around this town.
Nothing, bro.
We can't do that? Jump a curb? Come on, get a little crazy?
Nope.
Come on, man. We put some tall bars on it. Your knees will fit under there. You look great.
Oh, thanks, man.
Well, you can sell me this thing or not. I mean, I am calling here. I'm trying. I'm like, wheeling and dealing. I want to buy this thing. You're like, no, don't buy it. It's too big. Oh. I'm like, what the hell?
Yeah, just come in person, man. I mean, if you're serious, come in person.
All right. I got this address here down there on 3rd Street.
Yep.
I just come ask for Joe. You give me a ride. We'll do two up on this thing. Kick some ass around L.A.
Sounds good, man.
All right, bro. Hey, Pop Wheelies, Sizzle Chest. We'll see you later.
All right. Well, that was Barry Goldberg trying to get a sale there to get
real,
a quad.
Real good with a quad there.
Popping wheelies and shit. All right. That jumps us into our 4-Wheel Parts Get At Me Q&A session. 4-Wheel Parts is the leader in off-road truck, Jeep, Sprinter, and UTV parts and service. If you've got any of those things, that's your place to go. Wheels, tires, suspension, tops, lift kits, bar steps, lights, winches, literally anything you would need as a UTV fan, someone with a Jeep, truck, Sprinter, you can get it there. You can also get Method Race wheels and Dunlop tires. So go to 4wheelparts.com, the number 4wheelparts.com, and check those guys out. Stoked to have them on board. That brings us to our Q&A, our 4-Wheel Parts Get At Me Q&A session. These came in from our Twitter account. People had some questions. Donnie, what do we got on deck today?
Yeah, I got the first question from Randy at Ranham84, and he said, so which 450 class rookie will you get the best single race finish out of? And which rookie will finish the highest in the points?
Gio, what do you think? I'm gonna. You want me to go first?
Wait, I'm trying to think. Is Justin Hill 450?
Yeah, you could call him a rookie. I mean, he did some last year, but this would be his first full season.
But I'm saying, full season.
He's one of your guys. You got Zach Osborne,
Savachi,
Plessinger.
You know what?
Plessinger had a little get off, so I don't know how fresh he's going to be. I'm going to say this right here. Your best finish all season is going to be for Savachi.
Best finish.
I think that guy's got some – I think he fits that 450. He showed so much speed at the Monster Cup. I'm putting him in for our best finish, and I think your best overall result, highest in the standings, Zach Osborne. I think he's solid. He's consistent. He showed that he's riding well.
I would agree with you with the Osborne part, but I think Plessinger gets the best result.
What is it? Where do you think he's at?
I mean, we got a few
– podium?
I think we got a couple races back east. If the weather or certain elements come into play, I say Plessinger wins
the race.
At least one.
All right.
I'd say he wins one, Savachi doesn't.
Wow, that's big to say he's going to win one, huh?
Yeah, I'd just like to argue with you as well.
Yeah,
so,
no, that's good. Okay, that's good.
Cool.
I'm not putting any money on it, so it's fine.
All right.
If you win, you buy yourself a drink. How's that? All right, well, that's where we're at. What else we got?
All right, we got from...
I'm winning.
We got from Greeling. He wants to know, how often do you guys ride, and where is your favorite place to ride?
How often do I ride? Probably, 3 to 4 times a month? Just depends kind of how many bike tests. I just pretty much for me...
3 to 4 times a month?
Yeah.
I heard your
wife
say
I'm lying. No, truly.
No, that's literally what I was thinking. She said it.
No, it's true. Listen, maybe.
Oh, you tell her you're going riding. You just don't tell her what or who or where. No. Ooh.
Wow. Just that, I'm getting heckled.
The worms are just flowing right now out of that can.
Maybe this time of year, there's a lot of new bikes, so I do a lot of bike tests.
Oh, he averages
That's work. Hey, how many times do I go ride for fun? Truly, maybe once a month. Probably not even that.
Oh, for fun?
He's averaging it out over the year. That's what he's doing.
It's amortized over 12 months.
Yeah,
I ride. I don't know.
Good answer.
I sound like Rogers when he talks about his dad. He's like, he's on it for a couple months, and then he's off, and then he's on, and then I feel like I'm that way nowadays. I don't get paid to go and do it, so I'm like, I'm going to get in shape, I'm going to kill it, I'm going to do this. And then I get distracted by shiny things, and then I'm off.
Do you know what I miss? I miss riding in the hills.
Yes.
I don't ever get to do it anymore. Because it takes an entire day. I cannot get a porch pass from the better half for that long. It's usually like I can sneak out for a few hours, and that's it. But after rain...
I just saw you in the hills like 2 weeks ago.
But that's not Beaumont or Retchie Canyon. Okay. That's not like the hills.
Those are the... Okay, there's hills, and then there's... Hills.
The foothills. He's like, those are hills. Okay.
Yeah, it's different. Yeah. All right. What else we got?
All right. We got from Big Brad. Seriously, another podcast? There are like a million of them things out there.
Seriously, big
fuck you, Brad.
Oh.
I mean, seriously,
stick it
you.
Up your ass, Brad.
Yeah.
Go ahead and tune out.
Yeah. Go grab a tall glass or shut the fuck up. No,
we're going to edit
Brad,
that in post,
you.
Folks.
Yeah. No. Brad, that's a great question.
Excellent question, Brad. I would submit there is not a podcast like this. There is not one that has...
I've never seen someone flipping off the guy that asked a question.
Yeah.
So you're right. There's only one like this, Brad. You won't find another one.
Yeah.
Should we give him something?
You're already upsetting the base. I mean...
The base.
Yeah, our base.
Is that our base?
Bad Brad's not our base.
You know, he's not.
Bad Brad can suck it.
He's getting a bag of coal for Christmas. Yeah.
Listen.
But anyway, good question. Why another podcast, you know? I mean, well, you know, Brad, I just think that there's people not tapping into our industry that need to be tapped into, and we're trying to tap into it. And tappity-tappity-tappity-tap.
We want to tap that ass of this industry. We're doing it.
Go buy a quad.
See, he already has one. There's a video of him wheeling it down the... He's Todd the quad god.
Yes. Yeah.
I think we'll leave it at that question.
All right. Well,
anyway, yeah. Thanks, Brad. Love the question.
All right. Listen, thank you, everybody, for tuning into our premiere episode. These are going to be a weekly show. So keep an eye out on our channels of social media, our website. If you're interested, you can also watch this on our YouTube channel. Just go to YouTube and search The Whiskey Throttle Show. You can check out the studio and the shenanigans and watch Grant flipping off our people that ride in. Also, if you're going to be in Southern California, a better way is to just come and hang out in person. January 4th is going to be our first live show. We've got Ricky Johnson, the bad boy, coming in. We're going to sit down with him and cover his life and career.
At least he'll take the focus off me.
That's right. So right here in the TLD Saloon, we've got Ricky Johnson coming in. You can get the tickets at thewhiskeythrottleshow.com or go to Road to Recovery, hit the shop button. You can buy them right there. $20 to get in, free 805 beer. You can hang out with some industry legends, get to meet RJ and chat with him, get an autograph, and know that 100% of those sales are going to go to Road to Recovery, help injured motocross riders and athletes. And like I said, just have a good time. It's going to be a fun show.
Well, they do a lot of cool things, Road to Recovery. We saw Weston Pike and his injury coming back. A lot of other athletes. They've been around a while, and it's been fun to, be a part of them.
Yeah, well, we want to do some good. We're not here just money grubbing and trying to,
There's no money grubbing.
There's no money to grub. Anyway, I also want you to get at us on our social media channels. So I'm running our Instagram account, which has a nice name, at Whiskey Throttle Show.
Oh, here we go.
Grant's going to run our Twitter account. Grant, why don't you share with the fans what our shitbox Twitter account handle is?
Well,
because I can't even memorize it. It's like a dash, a bleep, a click, 10 different little
emojis. Well, hold on. I'm pulling
emojis.
It up. Just... cut me some slack.
Here,
so anyway,
I'll tell you what it is. At @W_throttle_show.
I swear, I fucking tried my ass off. There's 15 characters, and like people have every way, shape, or form. I thought, oh, Whiskey Throttle's gone. Okay, I'll do Whiskey, but the I is a 1. Oh, I got this. I'm gone. Okay, Throttle, I'll do an 8. You know, like my number. Yeah. No, that's gone too. Okay. I got to the point, I'm like, who the fuck has all these fucking names? Like, how many Whiskey Throttle shows are there?
Hey, GL's just trying to find out who the real fan base is.
Apparently. So if you can remember, at @W_throttle_show, send us a tweet. We're probably not going to get any except Bad
or
Brad.
Just, or you could just search Whiskey Throttle and you'll...
It might show up. Anyway, send us some questions. We'll answer them here on our four-wheel parts Get At Me Q&A. Send us some questions on Instagram. If you got a question for RJ, we'll put it into our list and ask him. I'll try to give you some credit on air if we can. Big thanks to Pat Stott from 90s Motocross. He sent in some great questions this week for Roger D. So don't forget to go on and subscribe to this channel. That way it drops right onto your phone or whatever device you're listening on every single week. Thank you for watching. Anything else to add?
Oh, no, I've already...
You've added enough.
Cursed everyone out, so we're good.
All right, well, from the TLD Saloon, I am David Pingree. This is Grant Langston. I want to thank our producer, Donnie Bales,
And you guys keep twisting it, and we will see you back here January 4th. See ya. See ya.
All the anchor points were